The Phoenix Project, 5th Edition, by Gene Kim, Kevin Baer, and George Spofford. With new audio material, including the first three chapters of the DevOps Handbook and a new afterword by Gene Kim. Original text narrated by Chris Ruin. DevOps Handbook chapters and afterword narrated by Ron Butler. Published by IT Revolution Press. Find us at itrevolution.com in the Books and Free Resources section.
Press release by Kelly Lawrence, Chief Industry Analyst, Nestor Myers. For immediate release, Company, Parts Unlimited. Stock Trader Symbol, PAUD. Rating, Sell. Price Target, $8. Current, $13. Effective immediately, Parts Unlimited CEO Steve Masters is stepping down from his role as chairman after 8 years of holding that position. Board Director Bob Strauss, who served as company chairman and CEO 2 decades ago, is returning from retirement to assume the role of chairman. Parts Unlimited stock has tumbled 19% in the last 30 days under heavy trading, down 52% from its peak 3 years ago. The company continues to be outmaneuvered by its arch rival, famous for its ability to anticipate and instantly react to customer needs. Parts Unlimited now trails the competition in sales growth, inventory turns, and profitability. The company has long promised that its Phoenix program will restore profitability and close the gap by tightly integrating its retailing and e-commerce channels. Already years late, many expect the company to announce another program delay in its analyst earnings call next month. We believe that institutional investors such as Wayne Yokohama pressured Strauss to reconfigure the board as the first of many actions to right the ship in Elkhart Grove. A growing number of investors are pushing for more significant leadership changes and strategic options, such as splitting up the company. Despite Masters' past achievements that transformed Parts Unlimited into one of the top automotive parts manufacturers and retailers, we believe splitting up the chairman and CEO roles is long overdue. Parts Unlimited needs fresh leadership, either from the outside or from within. We believe Sarah Moulton, Senior Vice President of Retail Operations and a rising star at the company, could just be what the company needs. According to our sources, the board has given Strauss and Masters 6 months to make dramatic improvements. If they can't pull this off, expect more changes and turbulent times. Kelly Lawrence, Chief Industry Analyst, Nestor Myers. Part 1. Chapter 1. Tuesday, September 2nd. "Bill Palmer here," I say, answering my cell phone on the first ring. I'm late, so I'm driving 10 miles per hour over the speed limit instead of my usual 5. I spent the morning at the doctor's office with my 3-year-old son, trying to keep the other toddlers from coughing on us, constantly being interrupted by my vibrating phone. The problem of the day is intermittent network outages. As the director of mid-range technology operations, I'm responsible for the availability and smooth functioning of a relatively small IT group at Parts Unlimited, a $4 billion per year manufacturing and retail company based in Elkhart Grove. Even in the technology backwaters I've chosen to make my turf, I need to track network issues closely. Because these issues disrupt the services my group provides, people will blame the outages on me. "Hi, Bill. This is Laura Beck from Human Resources." She's not the person I usually deal with from HR, but her name and voice sound familiar. Holy crap. I try not to swear out loud when I remember who she is. From the monthly company meetings. She's the VP in charge of HR. "Good morning, Laura," I say with forced cheer. "What can I do for you?" She responds, "When will you be in the office? I'd like to meet as soon as possible." I hate vague requests to meet. I only do them when I'm trying to schedule a time to chew someone out, or fire them. Wait. Is Laura calling because someone wants to fire me? Was there an outage I didn't respond to quickly enough? As an IT operations guy, the career-ending outage is the joke my peers and I tell one another daily. We agree to meet at her desk in a half hour, but when she doesn't share any more details, I say in my most cajoling voice, "Laura, what's this all about? Is there a problem in my group? Or am I the one in trouble?" I laugh extra loudly so she hears it over the phone. "No, it's nothing like that," she says breezily. "You could even say this is good news. Thanks, Bill." When she hangs up, I try to think of what good news would even look like these days. When I can't, I turn the radio back on and immediately hear a commercial from our largest retailing competitor. They're talking about their unparalleled customer service and a breathtaking new offering that allows people to customize their cars with their friends online. The ad is brilliant. I'd use the service in a second if I weren't such a loyal company man. How do they keep bringing such incredible new capabilities to market while we remain stuck in the mud? I turn the radio off. Despite all our hard work and late nights, the competition keeps leapfrogging us. When our marketing people hear this ad, they'll go ballistic, because they're likely art or music majors, not people with a technology background. They'll publicly promise the impossible, and IT will have to figure out how to deliver. Each year, it gets harder. We have to do more with less to simultaneously maintain competitiveness and reduce costs. Some days, I think that it can't be done. Maybe I spent too much time as a sergeant in the Marines. You learn that you argue your case as best as you can with your officer, but sometimes you have to say, "Yes, sir," and then go take that hill. I pull into the parking lot. 3 years ago, finding an empty parking spot was impossible. Now, after all the layoffs, parking is rarely a problem. When I walk into Building 5, where Laura and her staff reside, I immediately notice how nicely furnished it is. I can smell the new carpeting, and there's even classy wood paneling on the walls. Suddenly, the paint and carpet in my building seem decades overdue for replacement. That's IT's lot in life. At least we're not in a dingy, dimly lit, dank basement, like in the British TV show, The IT Crowd. When I get to Laura's office, she looks up and smiles. "Good seeing you again, Bill." She extends her hand, which I shake. "Have a seat while I see whether Steve Masters is available to meet." "Steve Masters? Our CEO?" She picks up and dials her phone while I sit down, looking around. The last time I was here was a couple of years ago, when HR notified us that we needed to dedicate a room for nursing mothers. We were critically short of office and meeting space, and we had big project deadlines looming. We merely wanted to use a conference room in a different building. However, Wes made it sound like we were a bunch of 1950s madmen Neanderthals. Shortly afterward, we were both summoned here for a half day of political rehabilitation and sensitivity training. Thanks, Wes. Among other things, Wes is in charge of the networks, which is why I track network outages so closely. Laura thanks the person on the other end of the phone and turns back to me. "Thanks for coming down on short notice. How is your family doing these days?" she asks. My brow furrows. If I wanted to chit-chat, there are many people I'd rather talk to than someone in HR. I force myself to banter about our families and kids, trying not to think about my other pressing commitments. Eventually, I say, without much grace, "So what can I do for you this morning?" "Of course," she pauses and then says, "Effective as of this morning, Luke and Damon are no longer with the company. This went all the way to the top, with Steve getting involved. He's chosen you to be the VP of IT operations." She smiles broadly, holding out her hand again. "You're our newest VP in the company, Bill. I think some congratulations are in order." "Holy crap." I numbly shake her hand. "No, no, no. The last thing I want is a promotion. Luke was our CIO, or Chief Information Officer. Damon worked for him and was my boss, in charge of IT operations across the entire company. Both gone, just like that." I didn't see this coming. There wasn't any chatter on the subspace radio. Nothing. For the last decade, like clockwork, new CIOs would come and go every 2 years. They stay just long enough to understand the acronyms, learn where the bathrooms are, implement a bunch of programs and initiatives to upset the apple cart, and then they're gone. CIO stands for Career is Over. And VPs of IT operations don't last much longer. I've figured out that the trick to a long career in IT operations management is to get enough seniority to get good things done, but to keep your head low enough to avoid the political battles that make you inherently vulnerable. I have absolutely no interest in becoming one of the VPs who just give each other PowerPoints all day long. Fishing for more information, I joke. Two executives leaving at the same time? Were they stealing money from the stores late at night? She laughs, but quickly returns to her HR-trained deadpan. They both chose to pursue other interests. More than that, you'll have to find out from them. As the saying goes, if your colleague tells you they've decided to quit, it was voluntary. But when someone else tells you they've decided to quit, it was mandatory. Ergo, my boss and his boss were just whacked. This is exactly why I don't want a promotion. I'm extremely proud of the team I've built over the last 10 years. It's not the largest group, but we're the most organized and dependable by far, especially compared to Wes. I groan at the thought of managing Wes. He doesn't manage a team. He's barely one step ahead of a chaotic mob. As I break out in a cold sweat, I know I will never accept this promotion. All this time, Laura has been talking, and I haven't heard a single word.
And so we'll obviously need to talk about how we're going to announce this transition, and Steve wants to see you as soon as possible.
Look, thanks for the opportunity. I'm honored. But I don't want this role. Why would I? I love my current job, and there are tons of important things that still need to be done.
I don't think this is optional, she says, looking sympathetic. This came straight from Steve. He chose you personally, so you'll have to talk with him.
I stand up and reiterate firmly, no, really. Thanks for thinking of me, but I've already got a great job. Good luck finding someone else. Minutes later, Laura is walking me to Building 2, the tallest building on campus. I'm angry at myself for getting sucked into this insanity. If I run now, I'm pretty sure she wouldn't be able to catch me, but then what? Steve would just send a whole squad of HR goons to fetch me. I don't say anything, definitely not feeling like small talk anymore. Laura doesn't seem to care, walking briskly beside me, nose buried in her phone, occasionally gesturing directions. She finds Steve's office without ever looking up, obviously having made this walk many times before. This floor is warm and inviting, furnished just like it was in the 1920s when the building was constructed. With dark hardwood floors and stained glass windows, it's from an era when everyone wore suits and smoked cigars in their offices. The company was booming then. Parts Unlimited made various widgets inside almost every make of automobile, when horses were being vanquished from daily life. Steve has a corner office, where a no-nonsense woman is keeping guard. She's about 40, radiating cheerfulness and a sense of organization and order. Her desk is tidy, with post-it notes everywhere on the wall. There's a coffee mug with the words, "Don't mess with Stacy," by her keyboard.
"Hi, Laura," she says, looking up from her computer. "Busy day, huh? So this is Bill."
"Yep, in the flesh," Laura replies, smiling. To me, she says,
"Stacy keeps Steve in line. You'll grow to know her well, I suspect. You and I can finish up later."
Then she leaves. Stacy smiles at me.
"Pleasure. I've heard a lot about you already. Steve is expecting you."
She points to his door. I immediately like her, and I think about what I've just learned. It's been a busy day for Laura. Stacy and Laura are on very familiar terms. Steve has HR on speed dial. Apparently, people who work for Steve don't last long. Great. Walking in, I'm a little surprised to find Steve's office looks just like Laura's. It's the same size as my boss's office, or rather, my ex-boss's office,
and potentially my new office if I'm stupid, which I am not. Maybe I was expecting Persian rugs, water fountains, and large sculptures everywhere. Instead, there are photos on the wall of a small propeller airplane, his smiling family, and, to my surprise, one of him in a U.S. Army uniform on a runway somewhere tropical. I note with surprise the insignia visible on his lapels. So, Steve was a major. He is sitting behind his desk, scrutinizing what appear to be paper spreadsheets. There's a laptop open behind him, displaying a browser full of stock graphs. "Bill, good to see you again," he says, standing and shaking my hand. "It's been a long time. About 5 years, right? It was after you pulled off that amazing project to integrate one of the manufacturing acquisitions. I trust life has been treating you well." I'm surprised and a bit flattered that he remembered our brief interaction, especially when it was so long ago. I smile in return, saying, "Yes, very well, thank you. I'm amazed you remember something so far back." "You think we give out awards like that to just anyone?" he says earnestly. "That was an important project. To make that acquisition pay off, we needed to nail it, which you and your team did superbly. I'm sure Laura has told you a bit about the organizational changes I've made. You know Luke and Damon are no longer with the company. I intend to fill the CIO position eventually, but in the meantime, all of IT will report to me." He continues, brisk and businesslike. "However, with Damon's departure, I have an organizational hole I need to fill. Based on our research, you're clearly the best candidate to take over as VP of IT operations." As if he just remembered, he says, "You were a Marine. When and where?" I announce automatically, "22nd Marine Expeditionary Unit, Sergeant. I was in for 6 years but never saw combat." Remembering how I joined the Marines as a cocky 18-year-old, I say with a smile, "The Corps really straightened me out. I owe them a lot, but I sure hope neither of my sons join under the same conditions I did." "I bet," Steve laughs. "I was in the Army for 8 years myself, slightly longer than I was obligated to. But I didn't mind. ROTC was the only way I could pay for college, and they treated me well." He adds, "They didn't coddle us like they did you Marines, but I still can't complain." I laugh, finding myself liking him. This is the longest interaction we've had. I suddenly wonder if this is what politicians are like. I try to stay focused on why he summoned me here. He's going to ask me to undertake some kamikaze mission. "Here's the situation," he says, motioning me to have a seat at his conference table. "As I'm sure you're aware, we must regain profitability. To do that, we need to increase our market share and average order sizes. Our retail competitors are kicking our ass. The whole world knows this, which is why our stock price is half what it was 3 years ago." He continues, "Project Phoenix is essential to closing the gap with the competition, so we can finally do what the competition has been doing for years. Customers need to be able to buy from us from wherever they want, whether it's on the internet or in our retail stores. Otherwise, we'll soon have no customers, at all." I nod. I might be in the technology backwaters, but my team has been involved with Phoenix for years. Everyone knows how important it is. "We're years late delivering," he continues. "Our investors and Wall Street are howling, and now my board is losing confidence in our ability to hit our commitments. I'll be blunt," he says. "The way things are going, I'll be out of a job in 6 months. As of last week, Bob Strauss, my old boss, is the new chairman of the company. There's a vocal group of shareholders trying to split up the company, and I don't know how much longer we can fend them off. What's at stake here is not just my job, but the nearly 4,000 employees who work here at Parts Unlimited." Suddenly, Steve looks much older than the early 50s I had guessed him to be. Looking right at me, he says, "As acting CIO, Chris Allers, our VP of Application Development, will report to me. And so will you." He stands up and starts to pace. "I need you to keep all the things that are supposed to be up, well, up. I need someone reliable, who isn't afraid to tell me bad news. Above all, I need someone I can trust to do the right thing. That integration project had many challenges, but you always kept a cool head. You've built a reputation as someone who is dependable, pragmatic, and willing to say what you really think. He's been candid with me, so I reply with the same. Sir, with all due respect, it seems very difficult for senior IT leadership to succeed here. Any request for budget or staff is always shot down, and executives are replaced so quickly, some never even get a chance to fully unpack. With finality, I say, mid-range operations is critical to getting Phoenix done too. I need to stay there to see those things through to completion. I appreciate you thinking of me, but I can't accept. However, I promise I'll keep my eyes open for any good candidates. Steve looks at me appraisingly, his expression surprisingly grave. We've had to cut budgets across the entire company. That edict came straight from my board. My hands were tied. I won't make promises I can't keep, but I can promise you I'll do whatever it takes to support you and your mission. Bill, I know you didn't ask for this job, but the company's survival is at stake here. I need you to help me save this great company. Can I count on you? Oh, come on. Before I can politely decline again, I suddenly hear myself saying, "Yes, sir, you can count on me." I panic, realizing that Steve somehow used some Jedi mind trick on me. I force myself to stop talking before I make some more dumb promises. "Congratulations," Steve says, standing up and shaking my hand firmly. He clasps my shoulder. "I knew you'd do the right thing. On behalf of the entire executive team, we're grateful for you stepping up." I look at his hand grasping mine, wondering if I can backpedal my way out. Not a chance in hell, I decide. Swearing to myself, I say, "I'll do my best, sir. And could you at least explain why no one who accepts this position lasts very long? What do you want most from me? And what don't you want?" With a resigned half-smile, I add, "If I fail, I'll try to make sure it's in a new and novel way." "I like that," Steve says, laughing loudly. "What I want is for IT to keep the lights on. It should be like using the toilet. I use the toilet, and, hell, I don't ever worry about it not working. What I don't want is to have the toilets back up and flood the entire building." He smiles broadly at his own joke. "Great. In his mind, I'm a glorified janitor." He continues, "You have a reputation of running the tightest ship in the IT organization, so I'm giving you the entire fleet. I expect you to make them all run the same way. I need Chris focused on Phoenix execution. Anything in your area of responsibility that takes focus away from Phoenix is unacceptable. That applies not just to you and Chris, but everyone else in this company. Is that clear?" "Absolutely," I say, nodding. "You want the IT systems to be reliable and available, and for the business to be able to depend on them. You want disruptions to normal operations kept to an absolute minimum so that the business can focus on getting Phoenix done." Looking surprised, Steve nods. "Exactly, yes, well put. Whatever you said, that's exactly what I want." He hands me an email printout from Dick Landry, the CFO. From Dick Landry to Steve Masters, date September 2nd, 8:27 a.m. Priority, highest. Subject, action needed. Payroll run is failing. "Hey, Steve, we've got serious issues with this week's payroll. We're trying to figure out if the problem is with the numbers or in the payroll system. Either way, thousands of employees have paychecks stuck in system and are at risk of not getting paid. Seriously bad news. We must fix this before payroll window closes at 5 p.m. today. Please advise on how to escalate this, given the new IT org. Dick." I wince. Employees not getting paychecks means families not being able to pay their mortgages or put food on the table. Suddenly, I realize that my family's mortgage payment is due in 4 days, and we could be one of the families affected. A late mortgage payment could screw up our credit rating even more, which we spent years repairing after we put Paige's student loans on my credit card. You want me to jump on this and manage the incident to conclusion? Steve nods, giving me the thumbs up. Keep me posted on the progress, please. His expression turns grave. Every responsible company takes care of its employees. Many of our factory workers live from paycheck to paycheck. Do not create hardship for their families, you hear? This could get us in trouble with the union, maybe even triggering a work stoppage, creating some very bad press for us. I nod automatically. Restore critical business operations and keep us out of the front page news. Got it. Thanks. Why exactly I'm thanking him is not clear. Chapter 2. Tuesday, September 2nd. How'd it go in there? Stacy asks kindly, looking up from her keyboard. I just shake my head. I can't believe it. He just talked me into taking a new job I don't want. How did that happen?
He can be very persuasive, she says. For what it's worth, he's one of a kind. I've worked for him for nearly 10 years, and I'll follow him anywhere. Anything I can help with to make your job easier?
Thinking for a moment, I ask. There's an urgent payroll issue that needs to be fixed. Dick Landry is on floor 3, right?
Here you go,
she says before I've finished asking my question, handing me a post-it note with all of Dick's contact information. Office location, phone numbers, and everything. Grateful, I smile at her.
Thanks a lot. You are fantastic.
I dial Dick's cell phone on my way to the elevator.
Dick here, he answers gruffly, still typing in the background.
This is Bill Palmer. Steve just made me the new VP of IT operations, and he asked me to...
Congratulations, he interrupts. Now look, my people found a huge payroll irregularity. When can you get to my office?
Right away, I reply. I hear the click of him ending the call. I've had warmer welcomes. On the third floor, I walk through finance and accounting, surrounded by pinstriped shirts and starched collars. I find Dick at his desk, still on the phone with someone. When he sees me, he puts his hand over the mouthpiece.
You from IT? He asks gruffly.
When I nod, he says into the phone,
Look, I gotta run. Someone who's supposedly going to help is finally here. I'll call you back.
Without waiting for an answer, he hangs up the phone. I've never actually seen someone who routinely hangs up on people. I brace myself for a conversation that is likely to be short on any comforting, let's get to know each other foreplay. As though in a hostage situation, I slowly raise my hands, showing Dick the printed email. Steve just told me about the payroll outage. What's the best way for me to get some situational awareness here?
We're in deep kimchi, Dick responds. In yesterday's payroll run, all of the records for the hourly employees went missing. We're pretty sure it's an IT issue. This screw-up is preventing us from paying our employees, violating countless state labor laws, and, no doubt, the union is going to scream bloody murder.
He mutters under his breath for a moment.
Let's go see Anne, my operations manager. She's been pulling her hair out since yesterday afternoon.
Walking quickly to keep up, I nearly run into him when he stops and peers through a conference room window. He opens the door.
How's it going in here, Anne?
There are two well-dressed women in the room. One, around 45 years old, studies the whiteboard, filled with flowcharts and a lot of tabulated numbers, and the other, in her early 30s, types on a laptop. Spreadsheets are strewn all over the large conference room table. The older woman gestures with an open marker at what appears to be a list of potential failure causes. Something about the way they dress, and their concerned and irritated expressions, makes me think they were recruited from a local accounting firm. Ex-auditors. Good to have them on our side, I suppose. Anne shakes her head in exhausted frustration.
Not much progress, I'm afraid. We're almost certain it's an IT systems failure in one of the upstream timekeeping systems. All of the hourly factory worker records got screwed up in the last upload,
Dick interrupts her.
This is Bill from IT. He's been assigned to fix this mess or die trying, is what I think he said.
I say, Hi guys, I've been made the new head of IT operations. Can you start from the beginning and tell me what you know about the problem? Anne walks over to the flowchart on the whiteboard.
Let's start with the information flow. Our financial system gets payroll data from our various divisions in different ways. We roll up all the numbers for salaried and hourly personnel, which includes wages and taxes. Sounds easy, but it's extremely complex, because each state has different tax tables, labor laws, and so forth. To make sure something doesn't get screwed up, she continues, we make sure the summarized numbers match the detailed numbers from each division. As I hurriedly jot down some notes, she continues, it's a pretty clunky and manual process. It works most of the time, but yesterday we discovered that the general ledger upload for hourly production staff didn't come through. All of the hourlies had zeros for their hours worked and amount due. We've had so many problems with this particular upload, she says, obviously frustrated, that IT gave us a program that we use to do manual corrections, so we don't have to bother them anymore. I wince. I don't like finance personnel manually changing payroll data outside the payroll application. It's error-prone and dangerous. Someone could copy the data onto a USB drive or email it outside of the organization, which is how organizations lose sensitive data. Did you say all the numbers for salaried employees are okay? I ask. That's right, she replies. But hourly employees are all zeros, I confirm. Yep, she again replies. Interesting. I ask, why do you think the payroll run failed when it was working before? Have you had problems like this in the past? She shrugs. Nothing like this has happened before. I have no idea what could have caused it. No major changes were scheduled for this pay period. I've been asking the same questions, but until we hear from the IT guys, we're stuck dead in the water. What is our backup plan? I ask. If things are so hosed that we can't get the hourly employee data in time.
For crying out loud, Dick says. It's in that email you're holding. The deadline for electronic payments is 5 p.m. today. If we can't hit that window, we may have to FedEx bales of paper checks to each of our facilities for them to distribute to employees.
I frown at this scenario, and so does the rest of the finance team. That won't work, Anne says, clicking a marker on her teeth. We've outsourced our payroll processing. Each pay period, we upload the payroll data to them, which they then process. In the worst case, maybe we download the previous payroll run, modify it in a spreadsheet, and then re-upload it. But because we don't know how many hours each employee worked, we don't know how much to pay them, she continues. We don't want to overpay anyone, but that's better than accidentally underpaying them. It's obvious that Plan B is fraught with problems. We'd basically be guessing at people's paychecks, as well as paying people who were terminated, and not paying people who were newly hired. To get finance the data they need, we may have to cobble together some custom reports, which means bringing in the application developers or database people. But that's like throwing gasoline on the fire. Developers are even worse than networking people. Show me a developer who isn't crashing production systems, and I'll show you one who can't fog a mirror, or more likely, is on vacation. Dick says,
these are two lousy options. We could delay our payroll run until we have the correct data, but we can't do this. Even if we're only a day late, we'll have the union stepping in. So that leaves Anne's proposal of paying our employees something, even if it's the incorrect amount. We'd have to just adjust everyone's paycheck in the next pay period. But now we have a financial reporting error that we've got to go back and fix.
He pinches the bridge of his nose and continues to ramble.
We'll have a bunch of odd journal entries in our general ledger just when our auditors are here for our SOX 404 audits. When they see this, they'll never leave. Oh, man. A financial reporting error, Dick mutters. We'll need approval from Steve. We're going to have auditors camped out here until the cows come home. No one will ever get any real work done again.
SOX 404 is short for the Sarbanes-Oxley Act of 2002, which Congress enacted in response to the accounting failures at Enron, WorldCom, and Tyco. It means the CEO and CFO have to personally sign their names, attesting that their company's financial statements are accurate. Everyone longs for the days when we didn't spend half our time talking to auditors, complying with each new regulatory requirement du jour.
I look at my notes and then at the clock. Time is running out. Dick, based on what I've heard, I recommend that you continue to plan for the worst and we fully document Plan B, so we can pull it off without further complications. Furthermore, I request that we wait until 3 p.m. before making a decision. We may still be able to get all the systems and data back. When Anne nods, Dick says,
Okay, you've got 4 hours.
I say, Rest assured that we understand the urgency of the situation and that you'll be appraised of how it's going as soon as I find out myself.
Thanks, Bill,
Anne says. Dick remains silent as I turn around and walk out the door. I feel better, now that I've seen the problem from the business perspective. It's now time to get under the covers and find out what broke the complex payroll machinery. While walking down the stairs, I dig out my phone and scan my emails. My feeling of calm focus disappears when I see that Steve hasn't sent out an announcement of my promotion. Wes Davis and Patty McKee, who until today were my peers, still have no idea that I'm now their new boss. Thanks, Steve. When I enter Building 7, it hits me. Our building is the ghetto of the entire Parts Unlimited campus. It was built in the 1950s and last remodeled in the 1970s, obviously built for utility, not aesthetics. Building 7 used to be our large brake pad manufacturing factory until it was converted into data center and office space. It looks old and neglected. The security guard says cheerfully, Hello, Mr. Palmer. How's the morning going so far? For a moment, I'm tempted to ask him to wish me luck so he can get paid the correct amount this week. Of course, I merely return his friendly greeting. I'm headed toward the Network Operations Center, or as we call it, the NOC, where Wes and Patty are most likely to be. They're now my two primary managers. Wes is Director of Distributed Technology Operations. He has a technical responsibility for over 1,000 Windows servers, as well as the database and networking teams. Patty is the Director of IT Service Support. She owns all the Level 1 and 2 help desk technicians who answer the phones around the clock, handling break fix issues and support requests from the business. She also owns some of the key processes and tools that the entire IT operations organization relies upon, like the trouble ticketing system, monitoring, and running the change management meetings. I walk past rows upon rows of cubicles, the same as every other building. However, unlike buildings 2 and 5, I see peeling paint and dark stains seeping through the carpet. This part of the building was built on top of what used to be the main assembly floor. When they converted it, they couldn't get all the machine oil cleaned up. No matter how much sealant we put down to coat the floors, oil still has a tendency to seep through the carpet. I make a note to put in a budget request to replace the carpets and paint the walls. In the Marines, keeping the barracks neat and tidy was not only for aesthetics, but also for safety. Old habits die hard. I hear the knock before I see it. It's a large bullpen area, with long tables set up along one wall, displaying the status of all the various IT services on large monitors. The level 1 and 2 help desk people sit at the three rows of workstations. It's not exactly like Mission Control in the movie Apollo 13, but that's how I explain it to my relatives. When something hits the fan, you need all the various stakeholders and technology managers to communicate and coordinate until the problem is resolved, like now. At the conference table, 15 people are in the midst of a loud and heated discussion, huddled around one of the classic gray speaker phones that resembles a UFO. Wes and Patty are sitting next to each other at the conference table, so I walk behind them to listen in. Wes leans back in his chair with his arms crossed over his stomach. They don't get all the way across. At 6'3" tall and over 250 pounds, he casts a shadow on most people. He seems to be in constant motion and has a reputation of saying whatever is on his mind. Patty is the complete opposite. Where Wes is loud, outspoken, and shoots from the hip, Patty is thoughtful, analytical, and a stickler for processes and procedures. Where Wes is large, combative, and sometimes even quarrelsome, Patty is elfin, logical, and level-headed. She has a reputation for loving processes more than people and is often in the position of trying to impose order on the chaos in IT. She's the face of the entire IT organization. When things go wrong in IT, people call Patty. She's our professional apologist, whether it's services crashing, web pages taking too long to load, or, as in today's case, missing or corrupted data. They also call Patty when they need their work done, like upgrading a computer, changing a phone number, or deploying a new application. She does all of the scheduling, so people are always lobbying her to get their work done first. She'll then hand it off to people who do the work. For the most part, they live in either my old group or in Wes's group. Wes pounds the table, saying, "Just get the vendor on the phone and tell them that unless they get a tech down here pronto, we're going to the competition. We're one of their largest customers. We should probably have abandoned that pile of crap by now, come to think of it." He looks around and jokes. "You know the saying, right? The way you can tell a vendor is lying is when their lips are moving." One of the engineers across from Wes says, "We have them on the phone right now. They say it'll be at least 4 hours before their sand field engineer is on site." I frown. Why are they talking about the sand? Storage area networks provide centralized storage to many of our most critical systems, so failures are typically global. It won't be just one server that goes down. It'll be hundreds of servers that go down all at once. While Wes starts arguing with the engineer, I try to think. Nothing about this payroll run failure sounds like a SAN issue. Anne suggested that it was probably something in the timekeeping application supporting each plant. "But after we tried to roll back the SAN, it stopped serving data entirely," another engineer says. "Then the display started displaying everything in kanji." "Well, we think it was kanji. Whatever it was, we couldn't make heads or tails of those little pictures. That's when we knew we needed to get the vendor involved." Although I'm joining late, I'm convinced we're totally on the wrong track. I lean in to whisper to Wes and Patty, "Can I get a minute with you guys in private?" Wes turns and, without giving me his full attention, says loudly, "Can't it wait? In case you haven't noticed, we're in the middle of a huge issue here." I put my hand firmly on his shoulder. "Wes, this is really important. It's about the payroll failure and concerns a conversation I just had with Steve Masters and Dick Landry." He looks surprised. Patty is already out of her chair. "Let's use my office," she says, leading the way. Following Patty into her office, I see a photo on her wall of her daughter, who I'd guess is 11 years old. I'm amazed at how much she looks like Patty. Fearless, incredibly smart, and formidable, in a way that is a bit scary in such a cute little girl. In a gruff voice, Wes says, "Okay, Bill, what's so important that you think is worth interrupting a Sev-1 outage in progress?" That's not a bad question. Severity 1 outages are serious business-impacting incidents that are so disruptive, we typically drop everything to resolve them. I take a deep breath. "I don't know if you've heard, but Luke and Damon are no longer with the company. The official word is that they've decided to take some time off. More than that, I don't know." The surprised expressions on their faces confirm my suspicions. They didn't know. I quickly relate the events of the morning. Patty shakes her head, uttering a tisk-tisk in disapproval. Wes looks angry. He worked with Damon for many years. His face reddens. "So now we're supposed to take orders from you? Look, no offense, pal, but aren't you a little out of your league? You've managed the mid-range systems, which are basically antiques, for years. You created a nice, cushy little job for yourself up there. And you know what? You have absolutely no idea how to run modern distributed systems. To you, the 1990s is still the future." "Quite frankly," he says, "I think your head would explode if you had to live with the relentless pace and complexity of what I deal with every day." I exhale while counting to three. "You want to talk to Steve about how you want my job? Be my guest. Let's get the business what they need first and make sure that everyone gets paid on time." Patty responds quickly. "I know you weren't asking me, but I agree that the payroll incident needs to be our focus." She pauses and then says, "I think Steve made a good choice. Congratulations, Bill. When can we talk about a bigger budget?" I flash her a small smile and a nod of thanks, returning my gaze to Wes. A couple moments go by, and expressions I can't quite decipher cross his face. Finally, he relents.
Yeah, fine. And I will take you up on your offer to talk to Steve. He's got a lot of explaining to do.
I nod. Thinking about my own experience with Steve, I genuinely wish Wes luck if he actually decides to have a showdown with him. Thank you for your support, guys. I appreciate it. Now, what do we know about the failure, or failures?
What's all this about some SAN upgrade yesterday? Are they related?
We don't know, Wes shakes his head. We were trying to figure that out when you walked in.
We were in the middle of a SAN firmware upgrade yesterday when the payroll run failed. Brent thought the SAN was corrupting data, so he suggested we back out the changes.
It made sense to me, but as you know, they ended up bricking it.
Up until now, I've only heard bricking something in reference to breaking something small, like when a cell phone update goes bad, using it to refer to a $1 million piece of equipment where all our irreplaceable corporate data are stored makes me feel physically ill. Brent works for Wes. He's always in the middle of the important projects that IT is working on. I've worked with him many times. He's definitely a smart guy, but can be intimidating because of how much he knows. What makes it worse is that he's right most of the time.
You heard them,
Wes says, gesturing toward the conference table where the outage meeting continues unabated.
The SAN won't boot,
won't serve data, and our guys can't even read any of the error messages on the display because they're in some weird language. Now we've got a bunch of databases down, including, of course, payroll.
To work the SAN issue,
we had to pull Brent off of a Phoenix job we promised to get done for Sarah, Patty says ominously. There's going to be hell to pay.
Uh-oh. What exactly did we promise her? I ask, alarmed. Sarah is the senior vice president of retail operations, and she also works for Steve. She has an uncanny knack for blaming other people for her screw-ups, especially IT people. For years, she's been able to escape any sort of real accountability. Although I've heard rumors that Steve is grooming her as his replacement, I've always discounted that as being totally impossible. I'm certain that Steve can't be blind to her machinations.
Sarah heard from someone that we were late getting a bunch of virtual machines over to Chris, she replies. We dropped everything to get on it. That is,
until we had to drop everything to fix the SAN.
Chris Allers, our VP of application development, is responsible for developing the applications and code that the business needs, which then get turned over to us to operate and maintain. Chris's life is currently dominated by Phoenix. I scratch my head. As a company, we've made a huge investment in virtualization. Although it looks uncannily like the mainframe operating environment from the 1960s, virtualization changed the game in Wes's world. Suddenly, you don't have to manage thousands of physical servers anymore. They're now logical instances inside of one big iron server, or maybe even residing somewhere in the cloud. Building a new server is now a right click inside of an application. Cabling? It's now a configuration setting. But despite the promise that virtualization was going to solve all our problems, here we are, still late in delivering a virtual machine to Chris.
If we need Brent to work the SAN issue, keep him there. I'll handle Sarah, I say. But if the payroll failure was caused by the SAN, why didn't we see more widespread outages and failures?
Sarah is definitely going to be one unhappy camper. You know, suddenly I don't want your job anymore, Wes says with a loud laugh. Don't get yourself fired on your first day. They'll probably come for me next.
Wes pauses to think.
You know, you have a good point about the SAN. Brent is working the issue right now. Let's go to his desk and see what he thinks.
Patty and I both nod. It's a good idea. We need to establish an accurate timeline of relevant events. And so far, we're basing everything on hearsay. That doesn't work for solving crimes, and it definitely doesn't work for solving outages. Chapter 3, Tuesday, September 2nd.
I follow Patty and Wes as they walk past the knock, into the sea of cubicles.
We end up in a giant workspace created by combining six cubicles. A large table sits against one wall with a keyboard and four LCD monitors, like a Wall Street trading desk. There are piles of servers everywhere, all with blinking lights. Each portion of the desk is covered by more monitors, showing graphs, login windows, code editors, Word documents, and countless applications I don't recognize. Brent types away in a window, oblivious to everything around him. From his phone, I hear the knock conference line. He obviously doesn't seem worried that the loud speakerphone might bother his neighbors.
"Hey, Brent, you got a minute?"
Wes asks loudly, putting a hand on his shoulder.
"Can it wait?" Brent replies without even looking up. "I'm actually kind of busy right now. Working the SAN issue, you know?"
Wes grabs a chair.
"Yeah, that's what we're here to talk about."
When Brent turns around, Wes continues,
"Tell me again about last night. What made you conclude that the SAN upgrade caused the payroll run failure?"
Brent rolls his eyes.
"I was helping one of the SAN engineers perform the firmware upgrade after everybody went home. It took way longer than we thought. Nothing went according to the tech note. It got pretty hairy, but we finally finished around 7 o'clock. We rebooted the SAN, but then all the self-tests started failing. We worked it for about 15 minutes, trying to figure out what went wrong. That's when we got the emails about the payroll run failing. That's when I said, game over. We were just too many versions behind. The SAN vendor probably never tested the upgrade path we were going down. I called you, telling you I wanted to pull the plug. When you gave me the nod, we started the rollback. That's when the SAN crashed," he says, slumping in his chair. "It not only took down payroll, but a bunch of other servers too. We've been meaning to upgrade the SAN firmware for years, but we never got around to it,"
Wes explains, turning to me. "We came close once, but then we couldn't get a big enough maintenance window. Performance has been getting worse and worse, to the point where a bunch of critical apps were being impacted. So finally, last night, we decided to just bite the bullet and do the upgrade." I nod. Then my phone rings. It's Anne, so I put her on speakerphone.
"As you suggested, we looked at the data we pulled from the payroll database yesterday. The last pay period was fine, but for this pay period, all the social security numbers for the factory hourlies are complete gibberish, and all their hours worked and wage fields are zeros too. No one has ever seen anything like this before."
"Just one field is gibberish?" I ask, raising my eyebrows in surprise. "What do you mean by gibberish? What's in the fields?" She tries to describe what she's seeing on her screen.
"Well, they're not numbers or letters. There's some hearts and spades and some squiggly characters, and there's a bunch of foreign characters with umlauts, and there are no spaces. Is that important?"
When Brent snickers as he hears Anne trying to read line noise aloud, I give him a stern glance. "I think we've got the picture," I say. "This is a very important clue. Can you send the spreadsheet with the corrupted data to me?" She agrees.
"By the way, are a bunch of databases down now? That's funny. They were up last night."
Wes mutters something under his breath, silencing Brent before he can say anything. Yes. We're aware of the problem and we're working it too," I deadpan. When we hang up, I breathe a sigh of relief, taking a moment to thank whatever deity protects people who fight fires and fix outages. "Only one field corrupted in the database?
Come on, guys. That definitely doesn't sound like a SAN failure," I say. "Brent, what else was going on yesterday, besides the SAN upgrade, that could have caused the payroll run to fail?"
Brent slouches in his chair, spinning it around while he thinks.
"Well, now that you mention it, a developer for the timekeeping application called me yesterday with a strange question about the database table structure. I was in the middle of working on that Phoenix test VM, so I gave him a really quick answer so I could get back to work. You don't suppose he did something to break the app, do you?"
Wes turns quickly to the speakerphone dialed into the NOC conference call that has been on this whole time and unmutes the phone.
"Hey guys, it's Wes here. I'm with Brent and Patty, as well as with our new boss, Bill Palmer. Steve Masters has put him in charge of all IT ops, so listen up, guys."
My desire for an orderly announcement of my new role seems less and less likely. Wes continues,
"Does anyone know anything about a developer making any changes to the timekeeping application in the factories? Brent says he got a call from someone who asked about changing some database tables."
From the speakerphone, a voice pipes up.
Yeah, I was helping someone who was having some connectivity issues with the plants. I'm pretty sure he was a developer maintaining the timekeeping app. He was installing some security application that John needed to get up and running this week. I think his name was Max. I still have his contact information around here somewhere. He said he was going on vacation today, which is why the work was so urgent. Now we're getting somewhere. A developer jamming in an urgent change so he could go on vacation, probably as part of some urgent project being driven by John Pesci, our chief information security officer. Situations like this only reinforce my deep suspicion of developers. They're often carelessly breaking things and then disappearing, leaving operations to clean up the mess. The only thing more dangerous than a developer is a developer conspiring with security. The two working together gives us means, motive, and opportunity.
I'm guessing our Chief Information Security Officer, or CISO, probably strong-armed a development manager to do something, which resulted in a developer doing something else, which broke the payroll run. Information security is always flashing their badges at people and making urgent demands, regardless of the consequences to the rest of the organization, which is why we don't invite them to many meetings. The best way to make sure something doesn't get done is to have them in the room. They're always coming up with a million reasons why anything we do will create a security hole that alien space hackers will exploit to pillage our entire organization and steal all our code, intellectual property, credit card numbers, and pictures of our loved ones. These are potentially valid risks, but I often can't connect the dots between their shrill, hysterical, and self-righteous demands and actually improving the defensibility of our environment. Okay, guys, I say decisively. The payroll run failure is like a crime scene, and we're Scotland Yard. The SAN is no longer a suspect, but unfortunately, we've accidentally maimed it during our investigation. Brent, you keep working on the injured SAN. Obviously, we've got to get it up and running soon. Wes and Patty, our new persons of interest are Max and his manager, I say. Do whatever it takes to find them, detain them, and figure out what they did. I don't care if Max is on vacation. I'm guessing he probably messed up something, and we need to fix it by 3 p.m. I think for a moment. I'm going to find John. Either of you want to join me? Wes and Patty argue over who will help interrogate John. Patty says adamantly, "It should be me. I've been helping to keep John's people in line for years. They never follow our process, and it always causes problems. I'd love to see Steve and Dick rake him over the coals for pulling a stunt like this." It is apparently a convincing argument, as Wes says, "Okay, he's all yours. I almost feel sorry for him now." I suddenly regret my choice of words. This isn't a witch hunt, and I'm not looking for retribution. We still need a timeline of all relevant events leading up to the failure. Jumping to inappropriate conclusions caused the SAN failure last night.
We won't make these kinds of mistakes again, not on my watch. As Patty and I call John, I squint at the phone number on Patty's screen, wondering if it's time to heed my wife's advice to get glasses. Yet another reminder that 40 is just around the corner. I dial the number, and a voice answers in one ring.
"John here." I quickly tell him about the payroll and SAN failure, and then ask,
"Did you make any changes to the timekeeping application yesterday?"
He says, "That sounds bad, but I can assure you that we didn't make any changes to your mid-range systems. Sorry I can't be of more help." I sigh. I thought that by now either Steve or Laura would have sent out the announcement of my promotion. I seem destined to explain my new role in every interaction I have. I wonder if it would be easier if I just sent out the announcement myself. I repeat the abridged story of my hasty promotion yet again. "Wes, Patty, and I heard that you were working with Max to deploy something urgent yesterday. What was it?"
"Luke and Damon are gone?"
John sounds surprised.
"I never thought that Steve would actually fire both of them over a compliance audit finding. But who knows?
Maybe things are finally starting to change around here. Let this be a lesson to you, Bill. You operations people can't keep dragging your feet on security issues anymore. Just some friendly advice.
Speaking of which, I'm suspicious about how the competition keeps getting the jump on us."
he continues. As they say, once is coincidence, twice is happenstance, third must be enemy action. Maybe our salespeople's email systems have been hacked. That would sure explain why we're losing so many deals. John continues to talk, but my mind is still stuck at his suggestion that Luke and Damon may have been fired over something security-related. It's possible. John routinely deals with some pretty powerful people, like Steve and the board, as well as the internal and external auditors. However, I'm certain Steve didn't mention either John or information security as reasons for their departure. Only the need to focus on Phoenix. I look at Patty questioningly. She just rolls her eyes and then twirls her finger around her ear. Clearly, she thinks John's theory is crazy. Has Steve given you any insights on the new org structure? I ask out of genuine curiosity. John is always complaining that information security was always prioritized too low. He's been lobbying to become a peer of the CIO, saying it would resolve an inherent conflict of interest. To my knowledge, he hasn't succeeded. It's no secret that Luke and Damon sideline John as much as possible, so he couldn't interfere with people who did real work. John still managed to show up at meetings, despite their best efforts. What? I have no clue what's going on, he says in an aggrieved tone, my question apparently striking a nerve. I'm being kept in the dark like usual. I'll probably be the last to find out, too, if history is any guide. Until you told me, I thought I was still reporting to Luke. And now that he's gone, I don't know who I'm reporting to. You got a call from Steve? This is all above my pay grade. I'm as much in the dark as you are, I respond, playing it dumb. Quickly changing the subject, I ask, what can you tell us about the timekeeping app change? I'll call Steve and find out what's going on. He's probably forgotten information security even exists, he continues, making me wonder whether we'll ever be able to talk about payroll. To my relief, he finally says, okay, yeah, you were asking about Max. We had an urgent audit issue around storage of PII, that is, personally identifiable information like SSNs, that's social security numbers, obviously, birthdays, and so forth. European Union law and now many U.S. state laws prohibit us from storing that kind of data. We got a huge audit finding around this. I knew it was up to my team to save this company from itself and prevent us from getting dinged again. That would be front page news, you know. He continues. We found a product that tokenized this information, so we no longer have to store the SSNs. It was supposed to be deployed almost a year ago, but it never got done, despite all my badgering. Now we're out of time. The payment card industry auditors, that's PCI for short, are here later this month, so I fast-tracked the work with the timekeeping team to get it done. I stare at my phone, speechless. On the one hand, I'm ecstatic because we found the smoking gun in John's hand. John's mention of the SSN field matches Anne's description of the corrupted data. On the other hand, let me see if I've got this right, I say slowly. You deployed this tokenization application to fix an audit finding which caused the payroll run failure, which has Dick and Steve climbing the walls. John responds hotly, first, I am quite certain the tokenization security product didn't cause the issue. It's inconceivable. The vendor assured us that it's safe, and we checked all their references. Second, Dick and Steve have every reason to be climbing the walls. Compliance is not optional. It's the law. My job is to keep them out of orange jumpsuits, and so I did what I had to do. Orange jumpsuits? Like what you wear in prison, he says. My job is to keep management in compliance with all relevant laws, regulations, and contractual obligations. Luke and Damon were reckless. They cut corners that severely affected our audit and security posture. If it weren't for my actions, we'd probably all be in jail by now. I thought we were talking about a payroll failure, not being thrown in jail by some imaginary police force. John? We have processes and procedures for how you introduce changes into production, Patty says. You went around them, and, once again, you've caused a big problem that we're having to repair. Why didn't you follow the process?
Ha! Good one, Patty, John snorts. I did follow the process. You know what your people told me? That the next possible deployment window was in 4 months. Hello? The auditors are on site next week, he says adamantly. Getting trapped in your bureaucratic process was simply not an option. If you were in my shoes, you'd do the same thing.
Patty reddens. I say calmly, according to Dick, we have fewer than 4 hours to get the timekeeping app up. Now that we know there was a change that affected SSNs, I think we have what we need. I continue. Max, who helped with the deployment, is on vacation today. Wes or Brent will be contacting you to learn more about this tokenization product you deployed. I know you'll provide them with whatever help they need. This is important. When John agrees, I thank him for his time.
Wait, one more question. Why do you believe that this product didn't cause the failure? Did you test the change?
There's a short silence on the other phone before John replies.
No, we couldn't test the change. There's no test environment. Apparently, you guys requested a budget years ago, but...
I should have known.
Well, that's good news, Patty says after John hangs up. It may not be easy to fix, but at least we finally know what's going on.
Was John's tokenization change in the change schedule? I ask. She laughs humorously.
That's what I've been trying to tell you. John rarely goes through our change process, nor do most people for that matter. It's like the Wild West out here. We're mostly shooting from the hip.
She says defensively,
we need more process around here and better support from the top, including IT process tooling and training. Everyone thinks that the real way to get work done is to just do it. That makes my job nearly impossible.
In my old group, we were always disciplined about doing changes. No one made changes without telling everyone else, and we'd bend over backward to make sure our changes wouldn't screw someone else up. I'm not used to flying this blind.
We don't have time to do interrogations every time something goes wrong, I say, exasperated. Get me a list of all the changes made in the past, say, 3 days. Without an accurate timeline, we won't be able to establish cause and effect, and we'll probably end up causing another outage.
Good idea, she nods.
If necessary, I'll email everyone in IT to find out what they were doing, to catch things that weren't on our schedule.
What do you mean, email everyone? There's no system where people put in their changes?
What about our ticketing system, or the change authorization system? I ask, stunned.
This is like Scotland Yard emailing everyone in London to find out who was near the scene of a crime.
Dream on, she says, looking at me like I'm a newbie, which I suppose I am. For years, I've been trying to get people to use our change management process and tools. But just like John, no one uses it. Same with our ticketing system. It's pretty hit or miss, too.
Things are far worse than I thought.
Okay, do what you need to do, I finally say, unable to hide my frustration. Make sure you hit all the developers supporting the timekeeping system as well as all the system administrators and networking people. Call their managers and tell them it's important that we know about any changes, regardless of how unimportant they may seem. Don't forget John's people, too.
When Patty nods, I say,
look, you're the change manager. We've got to do better than this. We need better situational awareness, and that means we need some sort of functional change management process. Get everyone to bring in their changes so we can build a picture of what is actually going on out there.
To my surprise, Patty looks dejected.
Look, I've tried this before. I'll tell you what will happen. The Change Advisory Board, or CAB, will get together once or twice, and within a couple of weeks, people will stop attending, saying they're too busy. Or they'll just make the changes without waiting for authorization because of deadline pressures. Either way, it'll fizzle out within a month.
Not this time, I say adamantly. Send out a meeting notice to all the technology leads and announce that attendance is not optional. If they can't make it, they need to send a delegate. When is the next meeting?
Tomorrow, she says.
Excellent, I say with genuine enthusiasm. I'm looking forward to it.
When I finally get home, it's after midnight. After a long day of disappointments, I'm exhausted. Balloons are on the floor, and a half-empty bottle of wine sits on the kitchen table. On the wall is a crayon poster saying, "Congratulations, Daddy." When I called my wife, Paige, this afternoon, telling her about my promotion, she was far happier than I was. She insisted on inviting the neighbors over to throw a little celebration. Coming home so late, I missed my own party. At 2 p.m., Patty had successfully argued that of the 27 changes made in the past 3 days, only John's tokenization change and the SAN upgrade could be reasonably linked to the payroll failure. However, Wes and his team were still unable to restore SAN operations. At 3 p.m., I had to tell Anne and Dick the bad news that we had no choice but to execute Plan B. Their frustration and disappointment were all too evident. It wasn't until 7 p.m. when the timekeeping application was back up and 11 p.m. when the SAN was finally brought back online. Not a great performance on my first day as VP of IT operations. Before I left work, I emailed Steve, Dick, and Anne a quick status report, promising to do whatever it takes to prevent this type of failure from happening again. I go upstairs, finish brushing my teeth, and check my phone one last time before going to bed, being careful not to wake up Paige. I curse when I see an email from our company PR manager, with a subject of, "Bad news, we may be on the front page tomorrow." I sit on the bed, squinting to read the accompanying news story. Elkhart Grove Herald Times. Parts Unlimited flubs paychecks. Local union leader calls failure unconscionable. Automotive parts supplier Parts Unlimited has failed to adequately compensate its workers, with some employees receiving no pay at all, according to a Parts Unlimited internal memo. The locally headquartered company admitted that it had failed to issue correct paychecks to some of its hourly factory workers and that others hadn't received any compensation for their work. Parts Unlimited denies that the issue is connected to cash flow problems and instead attributes the error to a payroll system failure. The once high-flying $4 billion company has been plagued by flagging revenue and growing losses in recent quarters. These financial woes, which some blame on a failure of upper management, have led to rampant job insecurity among local workers struggling to support their families. According to the memo, whatever the cause of the payroll failure, employees might have to wait days or weeks to be compensated. This is just the latest in a long string of management execution missteps taken by the company in recent years, according to Nestor Myers' chief industry analyst Kelly Lawrence. Parts Unlimited CFO Dick Landry did not return phone calls from the Herald Times requesting comment on the payroll issue, accounting errors, and questions of managerial competency. In a statement issued on behalf of Parts Unlimited, Landry expressed regret at the glitch and vowed that the mistake would not be repeated. The Herald Times will continue to post updates as the story progresses. Too tired to do anything more, I turn off the lights, making a mental note to myself to find Dick tomorrow to apologize in person. I close my eyes and try to sleep. An hour later, I'm still staring at the ceiling, very much awake. Chapter 4. Wednesday, September 3rd. I drink my coffee as I open up my laptop at 7:30 a.m., hoping to get through my emails and voicemails before my 8 a.m. meeting. I stare at the screen. In the 22 hours since I was promoted, 526 new emails have arrived in my inbox. Holy crap. I skip all the messages about yesterday's failure and am startled by all the congratulatory notes from vendors wanting to meet for lunch. How did they find out? I'm pretty sure most of my organization still doesn't know. I read an email from Ellen, my former boss's assistant, who is now assigned to support me, congratulating me and asking when we can meet. I reply, telling her I'd like to take her out for coffee this morning. I send a note to the IT service desk, requesting that Ellen be granted access to my calendar. A blinking red light on my desk phone catches my attention. It reads, 7:50 a.m., 62 new voicemails. My jaw drops. It would take an hour I don't have just to listen to them.
I email Ellen again, asking her to go through all my voicemails, transcribing any that require action. Before I hit send, I quickly add, "If there are any messages from Steve or Dick, please call me right away on my cell phone." Grabbing my clipboard, I hurry toward my first meeting when my phone vibrates. It's an urgent email. From Sarah Moulton to Bill Palmer. CC, Steve Masters. Date, September 3rd, 7:58 a.m. Priority, highest. Subject, latest Phoenix slip.
"Bill, as you know, Project Phoenix is the most important project this company is undertaking. I've heard disturbing rumors that you are holding up the release. I don't need to remind you that our competition isn't standing still. Each day that goes by, our market share goes down. I need everyone to have a sense of urgency, especially from you, Bill. We have an emergency project management meeting at 10 a.m. today. Please join us and be prepared to explain these unacceptable delays. Steve, I know how important this project is for you, given the commitments you've made to the board. Please feel free to attend. We'd love your perspective. Regards, Sarah."
Oh, no. I forward the email to Wes and Patty, flagging it as high priority. Something seems wrong in a world where half the email messages sent are urgent. Can everything really be that important? I call Wes's cell phone.
"I just got your email from Sarah," he says. "What utter bullshit."
"What's this all about?" I ask. He says,
"I'm pretty sure it's about Brent not finishing up that configuration work for the Phoenix developers. Everyone is chasing their tails because the developers can't actually tell us what the test environment should look like. We're doing our best, but every time we deliver something, they tell us we did it wrong."
"When did they tell us about it?" I ask.
2 weeks ago. It's the typical bullshit with development, but worse. They're so freaked out about hitting their deadlines, they're only now starting to think about how to test and deploy it. Apparently, they're making it our problem. I hope you're wearing your asbestos underwear like me. Sarah is going to be at that meeting with torches, wanting to throw us onto the bonfire."
It's amazing to me how handoffs between development and IT operations always get screwed up. But given the perpetual tribal warfare between the two groups, maybe I shouldn't be surprised. I reply, "I get the picture. Look, make sure you dig into this dev specification issue personally. We've got to get this nailed down. Grab everyone involved, whether they're in dev or ops, and lock them in a room until they come up with a written specification. Phoenix is so important, we can't afford to screw this up." Wes says he's on it, and I ask, "Is there anything else Sarah could pop on us?" He pauses to think and finally says,
"No, I don't think so. We have a pretty valid reason with the payroll run failure for why Brent wasn't able to complete his work."
I agree. Feeling like our asses are sufficiently covered, I say, "See you at 10. Less than an hour later, I'm walking to Building 9 in the hot sunshine, where many of the marketing folks call home. To my surprise, I join a small army of IT people walking the same way. Why? Then it hits me. The majority of our marketing projects can't be done without IT. High-touch marketing requires high-tech. But if there's so many of us assigned to these marketing projects, shouldn't they be coming to us? I imagine that Sarah likes it this way, the spider sitting back, enjoying seeing all the company minions making their way to her lair. I arrive and immediately see Kirsten Fingal, who runs the project management office, sitting at the head of the table. I am a big fan of hers. She is organized, level-headed, and a stickler for accountability. When she first joined the company 5 years ago, she brought a whole new level of professionalism to our organization. At her right, Sarah leans back in her chair, tapping away on her iPhone, oblivious to the rest of us. Sarah is my age, 39. She's very guarded about her age, always saying things in a way that would lead one to conclude she's much older, but never actually lying. Yet another maddening thing about Sarah. There are about 25 people in the room. Many of the business line owners are here, some of whom work for Sarah. Chris Allers is also here. Chris is a little older than me and looks lean and fit. He'll just as often be seen joking with someone as kicking their ass about missing a deadline. He has a reputation as a capable and no-nonsense manager. With nearly 200 developers working for him, he needs to be. To help with Phoenix, his team has grown by 50 people in the last 2 years, many through offshore development shops. Chris is constantly asked to deliver more features and do it in less time, with less money. Several of his managers are in the room, too. Wes is also here, sitting right next to Chris. As I start to look for an open chair, I note how everyone seems unusually tense, and then I see why. There, sitting right next to the only open seat at the table, is Steve. Everyone seems to be going to great lengths not to stare at him. As I casually take my seat next to Steve, my phone vibrates. It's a text message from Wes.
Shit! Steve has never attended a project management meeting. We are totally screwed.
Kirsten clears her throat.
First on our agenda is Phoenix. The news isn't good. This project went from yellow to red about 4 weeks ago, and it's my personal assessment that the deadline is in grave jeopardy.
She continues in her professional voice.
To refresh your memory, last week there were 12 tasks in the critical path of Phoenix Phase 1. Only 3 of those tasks were completed.
There is a collective groan in the room, and several people mutter to one another. Steve turns to look at me.
Well?
I explain.
The critical resource in question is Brent, who has been 100% utilized helping to recover from the payroll failure, which we all know about. This was a totally unforeseen emergency, but obviously one that we had to handle. Everyone knows how important Phoenix is, and we are doing everything we can to make sure Brent can stay focused.
Thanks for that super creative explanation, Bill, Sarah immediately responds. The real issue here is that your people don't seem to grasp how important Phoenix is to the company. Our competition is killing us in the market. You've all seen and heard the commercials about their new services. They're beating us on innovation, both in the retail stores and online. They've already lured away some of our biggest partners, and our sales force is starting to panic. I'm not the type to say, I told you so. But their latest product announcement shows why we can't be acting as if this is just business as usual.
She continues.
See, Bill, in order for us to increase market share, we must ship Phoenix. But for some reason, you and your team keep dragging your feet. Maybe you're not prioritizing correctly, or maybe you're just not used to supporting a project this important.
Despite all my mental preparation, I feel my face get hot with anger. Maybe it was the condescending way she was parroting Steve to me, or how she wasn't even looking at me while she was addressing me, instead looking at Steve to see how he reacts, or the way she basically called me out of touch and incompetent. Everyone is silent as I force myself to take a deep breath. My anger dissipates. This is all just corporate theater. I don't like it, but accept it for what it is. I almost made the Marines my career when I was up for promotion to staff sergeant. You don't become a senior NCO in the Marines without being able to play politics.
Interesting, I say to Sarah. You tell me which is more important, getting our factory employees paid or getting the Phoenix tasks done. Steve told me to resolve the payroll failure. How would you have prioritized this differently than Steve?
At my mention of Steve, Sarah's expression changes.
Well, maybe if IT didn't cause the failure in the first place, you wouldn't have blown your commitments to us. I don't think we can depend on you and your team.
I nod slowly, not taking the bait. I look forward to any suggestions you have to offer, Sarah. She looks at me, then at Steve. Apparently deciding there are no more points to be gained here, she rolls her eyes. I see Wes shaking his head in disbelief at this discussion, staying uncharacteristically quiet. Sarah continues.
We've spent over $20 million on Phoenix, and we're nearly 2 years late. We must get to market.
Looking over at Chris, she asks,
given the delays from Bill's group, when is the soonest we can go live?
Chris looks up from his papers.
I've looked into this since we talked last week. If we expedite some things, and if the virtualized environments from Bill's team work as expected, we can go into production 1 week from Friday.
I gape at Chris. He just made up an arbitrary date to go into production, with complete disregard for all the things we need to do before deployment. I have a sudden flashback. In the Marines, we had a ritual for all the senior NCOs. We'd hang out with beers and watch Star Wars, Return of the Jedi. Every time Admiral Akbar would cry, "It's a trap!" we'd all laugh uproariously, yelling for a replay. This time, I'm not laughing.
"Now just wait a minute here," Wes interjects, pounding the table. "What the hell are you trying to pull? We just found out 2 weeks ago about the specifics of the Phoenix deployment. Your guys still haven't told us what sort of infrastructure we need, so we can't even order the necessary server and networking gear. And by the way, the vendors are already quoting us 3-week delivery times." He is now facing Chris, pointing at him angrily. "Oh, and I've heard that the performance of your code is so shitty, we're going to need the hottest, fastest gear out there. You're supposed to support 250 transactions per second, and you're barely doing even 4. We're going to need so much hardware that we'll need another chassis to put it all in and probably have to pay a custom manufacturing fee to get it in time. God knows what this will do to the budget."
Chris wants to respond, but Wes is relentless.
"We still don't have a concrete specification of how the production and test systems should be configured. Oh, do you guys not need a test environment anymore? You haven't even done any real testing of your code yet, because that fell off the schedule too."
My heart lurches as all the implications sink in. I've seen this movie before. The plot is simple. First, you take an urgent, date-driven project, where the shipment date cannot be delayed because of external commitments made to Wall Street or customers. Then, you add a bunch of developers who use up all the time in the schedule, leaving no time for testing or operations deployment. And because no one is willing to slip the deployment date, everyone after development has to take outrageous and unacceptable shortcuts to hit the date. The results are never pretty. Usually, the software product is so unstable and unusable that even the people who were screaming for it end up saying that it's not worth shipping. And it's always IT operations who still has to stay up all night, rebooting servers hourly to compensate for crappy code, doing whatever heroics are required to hide from the rest of the world just how bad things really are. "Guys, I understand the desire to get Phoenix into production as quickly as possible," I say to Steve and Chris as calmly as I can. "But based on what we've heard from Wes, I think it's incredibly premature to deploy. We still don't know what equipment we need to hit the performance objectives, nor have we done any capacity testing to confirm our guesses. It's unlikely we have adequate documentation to run this thing in production, let alone get everything monitored and backed up." In my most persuasive voice, I continue, "I want Phoenix in the market as badly as anyone else. But if the user experience is bad enough, we'll end up driving our customers to the competition." I turn to Chris. "You can't just throw the pig over the wall to us and then high-five each other in the parking lot, congratulating yourselves on how you made the deadline. Wes is telling us that the pig will probably break its leg, and it'll be my guys who work all-nighters and weekends to keep that pig alive." Chris replies hotly, "Don't give me that bullshit about throwing the pig over the wall. We invited your people to our architecture and planning meetings, but I can count on one hand the number of times you guys actually showed up. We routinely have had to wait days or even weeks to get anything we need from you guys." Then he just holds up his hands, as if everything is outside his control. "Look, I'd like more time too. But from the very beginning, we all knew that this was a date-driven project. That was a business decision we all made."
"Exactly," Sarah exclaims before I can respond. "This just shows how Bill and his team lack the necessary sense of urgency. Perfection is the enemy of good. Bill, we simply do not have the luxury of time to polish this to whatever gold standard you're proposing. We need to create positive cash flow, and we cannot do that without taking back market share. And to do that, we need to deploy Phoenix." She looks over at Steve. "We understand risk, don't we, Steve?
You've been doing an absolutely amazing job selling this to analysts and even the guys on CNBC. I don't think we want egg on our face by shipping even later than we already are.
Steve nods his head and rubs his chin, rocking back and forth in his chair as he thinks.
Agreed, he finally says, leaning forward. We've made commitments to our investors and analysts that we were going to launch Phoenix this quarter.
My jaw drops. Sarah has blunted all my arguments, leading Steve down a reckless, destructive path. Exasperated, I say, does anyone think this is really odd? I've been in this room when we discussed installing new water fountains in the front of every store. We gave that team 9 months to plan the rollout. 9 months! And all of us agreed that was reasonable. Now, we're talking about Phoenix, which impacts thousands of point-of-sale systems and all of the back-office order entry systems. This is at least 10,000 times more complex than rolling out new water fountains, with way more risk to the business. And you're only giving us 1 week to plan and execute the rollout? I throw my hands up, imploring Steve, doesn't this seem a bit reckless and unfair? Kirsten nods, but Sarah says dismissively,
Bill, that's a touching story, but we're not discussing water fountains. We're discussing Phoenix. Besides, I believe the decision has already been made.
Steve says, Yes, it has. Thank you for sharing what you view as the risks, Bill. He turns to Sarah. When is the launch date? Sarah replies quickly,
Marketing launch is next Saturday, September 13th. Phoenix will deploy at 5 p.m. the previous day.
Steve writes the date in the back of his notebook and says, Good. Keep me posted on progress, and let me know if there's anything I can do to help. I look over at Wes, who mimes with his hands an airplane crashing into the table in front of him and bursting into flames. In the hallway, Wes says,
I thought that went pretty well, boss.
I'm not laughing.
What the hell happened in there? How did we get into this position? Does anyone know what's required from us to support this launch?
No one has a clue, he says, shaking his head in disgust. We haven't even agreed on how to do the handoff with development. In the past, they've just pointed to a network folder and said, Deploy that. There's newborn babies dropped off at church doorsteps with more operating instructions than what they're giving us.
I shake my head at his awful imagery, but he's right. We've got a serious problem here. He continues,
We're going to have to assemble a huge team, including Chris's guys, to figure out how we're going to pull this off. We have problems at every layer. Networking, servers, databases, operating systems, applications, layer 7 switching, the whole wad of crap. It's going to be late nights for all of us for the next 9 days.
I nod unhappily. This type of all-hands effort is just another part of life in IT, but it makes me angry when we need to make some heroic, diving catch because of someone else's lack of planning. I say, get your team assembled and ask Chris to assemble his respective team as well. Stop trying to do this by email and in the ticketing system. We need everyone in the same room. Speaking of commitments, I say, what was Chris referring to when he said that our guys never showed up to the Phoenix architecture and planning meetings? Is that true?
Wes rolls his eyes in frustration.
Yeah, it's true that his people would invite us at the last minute. Seriously, who can clear their calendar on less than a day's notice? Although, in fairness, he says after a moment, we did get ample notice on a couple of the big planning meetings. And one of the most critical people who needed to be there wasn't able to make it due to escalations. You can probably guess who that is.
I groan. Brent. Wes nods.
Yep. He's the guy we need at those meetings to tell those developers how things work in the real world and what type of things keep breaking in production. The irony, of course, is that he can't tell the developers because he's too busy repairing the things that are already broken.
He's right. Unless we can break this cycle, we'll stay in our terrible downward spiral.
Brent needs to work with developers to fix issues at the source so we can stop fighting fires. But Brent can't attend because he's too busy fighting fires. I say, we need our best minds to prepare for this deployment, so make sure Brent is there. Wes looks sheepish for a moment. I ask him, what?
I think he's working a network outage right now, he replies.
Not anymore, I say. They're going to have to fix it without him. If someone has a problem with that, send them to me.
Okay, whatever you want, boss,
he says, shrugging his shoulders. After the project management meeting, I'm in no mood to talk to anyone. I sit at my desk and grumble when my laptop doesn't wake up. The disk drive light just keeps blinking. When nothing shows on the screen, I grab my empty mug that I keep on my desk by the picture of Paige and my two sons and walk to the coffee machine in the corner. When I get back to my desk, a window on the screen tells me that it's going to install some critical new updates. I sit down, click OK, and watch the status bar crawl across the screen. Suddenly, I see the dreaded blue screen of death. My laptop is now completely locked up and unusable. It happens again, even after I reboot. I mutter in frustration, "You've got to be kidding me." Just then, Ellen, my new assistant, pokes her head around the corner. Holding out her hand, she says,
"Good morning. Congratulations on the promotion, Bill."
Noticing my blue-screened laptop, she says sympathetically,
"Ooh, that doesn't look good."
Thanks, I say, reaching out to shake her hand. "Yeah, about this laptop. Can you get a hold of someone in desktop support? There's some serious crap headed our way from Phoenix, and I'm going to need it."
"No problem," she says, nodding with a smile. "I'll tell them our new VP is hopping mad, demanding that his laptop get fixed. Of all people, you need a working computer, right? You know," she adds, "I've heard that a bunch of other people are having problems like this today. I'll make sure you get to the top of the list. You can't afford to wait in line."
More bricked laptops? This is surely evidence that the universe is out to get me today. "By the way, I need some help coordinating some emergency Phoenix meetings. Has anyone granted you access to my calendar yet?" I ask. She rolls her eyes.
"No, that's actually why I came down here. I wanted to see if you could print out your next couple of days. Obviously, that's out of the question. I'll have the desktop support person do that while he's here. Sometimes it takes weeks for the email administrators to get around to stuff like this."
Weeks? That's unacceptable. I quickly look at my watch and realize I'll have to tackle this later. I'm already late. "Do your best," I say. "I'm off to Patty's enterprise change management meeting. Call me if you need anything, okay?" Being 10 minutes late to Patty's meeting, I hurry into the room, expecting to see either a bunch of people waiting for me impatiently, or perhaps a meeting already underway. Instead, I see only Patty sitting at the conference table, typing away on her laptop.
"Welcome to the cab, Bill. I hope you can find an empty chair," she says.
"Where is everybody?" I ask. I'm baffled. When I ran the mid-range group, my team would never miss our change management meetings. It was where we coordinated and organized all our work to make sure we didn't shoot ourselves in the foot.
"I told you yesterday that change management around here is hit or miss," Patty says, sighing. "Some groups have their own local change management process, like yours, but most groups do nothing at all. Yesterday's outage is just proof that we need to have something at the enterprise level. Right now, the left hand rarely knows what the right hand is doing."
"So, what's the problem?" I ask. She purses her lip.
"I don't know. We sent a bunch of people to ITIL training so they could get up to speed on all the best practices. We brought in some consultants who helped us replace our ticketing system with an ITIL-compliant change management tool. People were supposed to put change requests into it where it would get routed for approvals. But even after 2 years, all we have is a great process on paper that no one follows and a tool that no one uses. When I pester people to use them, all I get are complaints and excuses."
I nod.
ITIL stands for IT Infrastructure Library, which documents many IT best practices and processes, and the ITIL program has had a reputation of spending years merely walking in circles.
I'm bothered that Wes isn't here. I know he's busy, but if he's not here, why would any of his people bother to show up? Efforts like this must start and be continually maintained from the top.
Well, they can bring their complaints and excuses to me, I say adamantly. We're rebooting the change management process, with my total support. Steve's told me to make sure people can stay focused on Phoenix. Screw-ups like the sand failure made us miss a Phoenix deliverable, and now we're paying for it. If someone wants to skip a change management meeting, they obviously are in need of some special compassionate coaching. From me.
At Patty's puzzled expression at my Phoenix reference, I tell her about how Wes and I spent our morning being run over by the bus. Sarah and Chris were at the wheel, but Steve was in back, cheering them on to floor it.
Not good, she says disapprovingly. They even ran over Kirsten, huh?
I nod silently, but refuse to say more. I always liked the phrase in Saving Private Ryan. There's a chain of command. Gripes go up, not down. Instead, I ask her to walk me through the current change process and the way it's been automated in the tools. It all sounds good, but there's only one way to see if the process works. I say,
schedule another cab meeting for the same time Friday. I'll send out an email to all the cab members letting them know that this is mandatory.
When I get back to my cubicle, Ellen is at my desk, bending over my laptop, writing a note.
Everything working, I hope? I ask.
She startles at the sound of my voice.
Oh my God, you scared me, she says, laughing. Support left you a replacement laptop because they couldn't get your laptop to boot, even after a half hour of trying.
She points at the far side of my desk, and I do a double take. My replacement laptop appears to be almost 10 years old. It's twice as large as my old one and looks three times as heavy. The battery has been taped on, and half the keyboard lettering is worn off from heavy use. For a moment, I wonder if this is a practical joke. I sit down and bring up my email, but everything is so slow that several times I thought it had locked up. Ellen has a sympathetic expression on her face.
The support guy said that this is all they have available today. Over 200 people are having similar problems, and many aren't getting replacements. Apparently, people with your laptop model also have had theirs break because of some security patch.
I forgot. It's Patch Tuesday, when John and his team roll out all their security patches from our major vendors. Once again, John is causing huge issues and disruptions for my team and me. I merely nod and thank her for the help.
After she's gone, I sit down and type out an email to all the cab members,
my keystrokes often taking 10 seconds to show up on the screen. From Bill Palmer to Wes Davis, Patty McKee, IT Operations Management. Date, September 3rd, 2:43 p.m. Priority, highest. Subject,
mandatory cab meeting Friday, 2 p.m. Today, I attended the weekly cab meeting. I was extremely disappointed that I was the only one there, besides Patty, especially given the totally avoidable change-related failure yesterday. Effective immediately, managers, or their assigned delegates, are required to attend all scheduled cab meetings and to perform their assigned duties. We are resurrecting the Parts Unlimited change management process, and it will be followed to the letter. Any persons caught circumventing change management will be subject to disciplinary action. There will be a mandatory cab meeting Friday at 2 p.m. See you there.
Call me if you have any questions or concerns. Thanks for your support, Bill. I hit send, waiting 15 seconds for the email to finally leave my outbox. Almost immediately, my cell phone rings. It's Wes. I say, I was just about to call you about the laptops. We've got to get replacements to our managers and employees so they can do their jobs, you hear?
Yeah, we're on it. But I'm not calling about that. And I'm not calling about Phoenix either, he says, sounding irritated.
Look, about your memo on change management.
I know you're the boss, but you better know that the last time we did one of these change management kumbayas, we ran IT straight into the ground. No one, and I mean absolutely no one, could get a single thing done. Patty insisted on having everyone take a number and wait for her pointy heads to authorize and schedule our changes. It was absolutely ridiculous and a total waste of time. He's unstoppable. That software application she made us use is a total piece of crap. It takes 20 minutes to fill out all those fields for a simple 5-minute change. I don't know who designed the process, but I think they assume that we all get paid by the hour and want to talk about doing work instead of actually doing work. Eventually, the networking and server team staged a rebellion, refusing to use Patty's tool, he continues heatedly. But John waved an audit finding around and went to Luke, our old CIO. And just like you did, Luke said that following policies was a condition of employment, threatening to fire anybody who didn't follow them. My guys were spending half their time doing paperwork and sitting in that damned cab meeting, he continues. Luckily, the effort finally died, and John was too clueless to catch on that no one was actually going to the meetings anymore. Even John hasn't gone to one of those meetings in over a year. Interesting. I hear you, I say. We can't repeat that, but we also can't have another payroll disaster. Wes, I need you there, and I need you to help create the solution. Otherwise, you're part of the problem. Can I count on you? I hear him sigh loudly. Yeah, sure. But you can also count on me calling bullshit if I see Patty trying to create some sort of bureaucracy that sucks out everybody's will to live. I sigh. Before, I was merely worried that IT operations was under attack by development, information security, audit, and the business. Now I'm starting to realize that my primary managers seem to be at war with each other as well. What will it take for us to get along? Chapter 5. Thursday, September 4th. I wake up with a jolt when the alarm clock goes off at 6:15 a.m. My jaw still hurts from clenching it all night. The dismal prospects of the upcoming Phoenix launch were never far from my mind. As usual, before climbing out of bed, I quickly scan my phone for any bad news. Usually, I would spend about 10 minutes replying to emails. It always feels good to lob a couple of balls off my side of the court. I see something that makes me bolt upright so abruptly that I wake up Paige. Oh my God, what? She asks frantically, not fully awake. It's another email from Steve. Hang on, darling, I say to her while I squint to read it. From Steve Masters to Bill Palmer, CC, Nancy Mailer, Dick Landry. Date, September 4th, 6:05 a.m. Priority, highest. Subject, urgent. SOX 404 IT Audit Findings Review. Bill, please look into this ASAP. I don't need to tell you how critical it is to have a clean SOX 404 audit. Nancy, please work with Bill Palmer, who is now in charge of IT operations. Steve. Begin forwarded message.
We just concluded our quarter 3 internal audit in preparation for the upcoming SOX 404 external audit. We discovered some very concerning deficiencies that we need to discuss with you. Due to the severity and urgency of the findings, we need to meet with IT this morning. Nancy.
Indeed, there's a 2-hour meeting scheduled for 8 a.m. on my calendar, set up by Nancy Mailer, Chief Audit Executive. Holy crap. She is incredibly smart and formidable. Years ago, during the retail acquisition integration, I watched her grill a manager from the business we were acquiring. He was presenting their financial performance when she started a rapid-fire interrogation, like a cross between Columbo, Matlock, and Scarface. He quickly broke, admitting that he was exaggerating his division's performance. Recalling that meeting, my armpits feel damp. I haven't done anything wrong, but given the tone of the email, she is clearly hot on the trail of something important, and Steve just threw me in her path. I've always run a very tight ship in my mid-range technology group. This kept audit from interfering too much. Sure, there would still be a lot of questions and documentation requests,
requiring us to spend a few weeks collecting data and preparing responses. Occasionally, they would find something, but we would quickly fix it. I like to think that we built a mutually respectful working relationship. However, this email portends something more ominous. I look at my watch. The meeting is in 90 minutes, and I don't have a clue about what she wants to talk about.
Shit!
I exclaim as I jostle Paige's shoulder. Honey, can you drive the kids to school today? Something really bad just came up involving a chief audit executive and Steve. I need to make some phone calls and get to the office right away. Annoyed, she says.
For 2 years, you've always taken the kids on Thursdays. I have an early start today, too.
I'm sorry, honey. This is really important. The CEO of the company asked me to handle this. Steve Masters. You know, the guy on TV and who gives the big speeches at the company holiday party. I can't drop another ball after a day like yesterday. And the newspaper headline the night before that. Without a word, she storms down the stairs. When I finally find the conference room for the 8 a.m. meeting, I immediately notice how silent it is, devoid of the usual small talk that fills the time while attendees trickle in. Nancy sits at the head of the table, with four other people sitting around her. Sitting next to her is John, along with his ever-present black three-ring binder. As always, I'm surprised by how young he is. He's probably in his mid-30s with thick, curly black hair. John has a haggard look about him, and like many college students, has continually gained weight in the 3 years he's been here at Parts Unlimited, most likely from all the stress associated with his failing moral crusade. John actually reminds me more of Brent than anyone else in the room. However, unlike Brent, who normally wears a Linux t-shirt, John wears a starched collared shirt that's slightly too large. Wes is conspicuously underdressed compared to everyone in the room, but he obviously doesn't care. The last person in the room is a young man who I don't recognize, presumably the IT auditor. Nancy begins.
We have just concluded our quarter three internal audit in preparation for the upcoming external SOX 404 audits. We have a grave situation. Tim, our IT auditor, found an eye-opening number of IT control issues. Worse, many are repeat findings going into the third year. Left unresolved, these findings may force us to conclude that the company no longer has sufficient controls to assert the accuracy of its financial statements. This could result in an adverse footnote from the external auditors in the company 10K filings with the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission. Although these are only preliminary findings, due to the gravity of the situation, I have already verbally informed the audit committee.
I blanch. Although I don't understand all the audit jargon, I know enough that this could ruin Dick's day and mean potentially more bad front-page news. Satisfied that I understand the severity of the situation, Nancy nods.
Tim, please walk us through your conclusions.
He takes out a huge stack of stapled papers, handing one out to everyone assembled.
We have just concluded our audit of the IT general controls at Parts Unlimited for all of the critical financial systems. It took a team of four people over 8 weeks to create this consolidated report. Holy crap!
I lift the 2-inch thick stack of papers in my hand.
Where did they find a stapler this big?
It's a printed Excel spreadsheet, with 20 rows per page in tiny 8-point type. The last page is numbered page 189.
There must be 1,000 issues here, I say in disbelief.
Unfortunately, yes, he responds, not entirely able to hide his smug satisfaction.
We found 952 IT general control deficiencies, of which 16 are significant deficiencies and 2 are potential material weaknesses. Obviously, we're very alarmed. Given how soon the external audit starts, we need your remediation plan as soon as possible.
Wes is hunched over the table, one hand on his forehead, the other hand flipping through page after page.
What kind of horse shit is this? He holds up one page. Issue 127. Insecure Windows Operating System Max Sin Cookie Setting. Is this a joke? In case you haven't heard, we've got a real business to run.
Sorry if that interferes with this full-time audit employment racket you've got going on here.
Trust Wes to say what people are thinking, but are too smart to actually say aloud.
Nancy responds gravely.
Unfortunately, at this point, the phase of control review and testing is over. What we require from you now is the management response letter. You need to investigate each of these findings, confirm them, and then create a remediation plan. We'll review it and then present to the audit committee and the board of directors.
Normally, you would have months to prepare your response letter and execute your remediation plan, she continues, suddenly looking apologetic.
Unfortunately, the way the audit testing calendar worked out, we only have 3 weeks until the external auditors arrive. That's regrettable. We'll make sure to give IT more time in the next audit cycle, but this time around, we require your response by...
She looks at her calendar.
1 week from Monday, at the very latest. Do you think you can make it?
Oh, shit. That's just 6 working days away. We'll need half that time just to read the entire document. Our auditors, who I've long believed are a force for justice and objectivity, are crapping on me too? I pick up the huge stack of papers again and look at a couple of random pages. There are many entries like Wes read, but others have references to inadequate security settings, presence of ghost login accounts, change control issues, and segregation of duties issues. John flips his 3-ring binder open and says officiously, Bill, I brought up many of the same issues with Wes and your predecessor. They convinced the CIO to sign a management waiver, stating that he accepted the risk and do nothing. Given that some of these are now repeat audit findings, I don't think we'll be able to talk our way out of it this time. He turns to Nancy. During the previous management regime, IT controls clearly weren't a priority. But now that all the security chickens are coming home to roost, I'm sure Bill will be more prudent. Wes looks at John with contempt. I can't believe John is grandstanding in front of the auditors. It's times like this that make me wonder whose side he's really on. Oblivious to Wes and me, John says to Nancy,
My department has been remediating some other controls, which I think we should be given credit for. For starters, we've completed the tokenization of the PII on our critical financial systems, so at least we dodged that bullet. That finding is now closed.
Nancy says dryly,
Interesting.
The presence of PII is not in the scope of the SOX 404 audit, so from that perspective, focusing on the IT general controls might have been a better use of time.
Wait. John's urgent tokenization change was for nothing?
If that's true, John and I need to talk later.
I say slowly,
Nancy, I genuinely don't know what we can get to you by Friday. We're buried in recovery work and are scrambling to support the upcoming Phoenix rollout. Which of these findings are the most important for us to respond to?
Nancy nods to Tim, who says,
Certainly. The first issue is the potential material weakness, which is outlined on page 7. This finding states that an unauthorized or untested change to an application supporting financial reporting could have been put into production. This could potentially result in an undetected material error due to fraud or otherwise. Management does not have any control that would prevent or detect such a change. Furthermore, your group was also unable to produce any change management meeting minutes, which is supposed to meet weekly, according to your policy.
I try not to wince visibly,
recalling that no one even showed up at the cab meeting yesterday, and during the payroll incident, we were so oblivious to John's tokenization change that we ended up bricking the SAN.
If we were clueless about those changes, I sincerely doubt that we'd notice if someone disabled a control that would enable a minor, say, $100 million fraudulent transaction.
Really? That's unbelievable. I'll look into that, I say with what I hope is the right amount of surprise and moral outrage, after I pretend to take detailed notes on my clipboard, circling and underlining random words. I nod, prompting Tim to continue.
Next, we found numerous instances where developers have administrative access to production applications and databases. This violates the required segregation of duty required to prevent risk for fraud. I look over to John. Really? You don't say. Developers making changes to an application without an approved change order? That certainly sounds like a security risk. What would happen if someone coerced a developer, say Max, into doing something unauthorized? We've got to do something about that. Right, John? John turns bright red, but says politely, Yes, of course. I agree and would be happy to help. Tim says, Good. Let's move on to the 16 significant deficiencies. A half hour later, Tim is still droning on. I stare glumly at the huge stack of findings. Most of these issues are just like the huge, useless reports we get from information security, which is another reason why John has such a bad reputation. It's the never-ending hamster wheel of pain. Information security fills up people's inboxes with never-ending lists of critical security remediation work, quarter after quarter. When Tim finally finishes, John volunteers, We must get these vulnerable systems patched. My team has a lot of experience patching systems if you require assistance. These audit findings are an awesome opportunity to close some big security holes. Look, both of you guys have no idea what you're asking for, Wes says to John and Tim, clearly exasperated. Some of the servers that those manufacturing ERP systems run on are over 20 years old. Half the company will grind to a halt if they go down, and the vendor went out of business decades ago. These things are so fragile that if you even look at them at the wrong time of day, they'll crash and require all sorts of voodoo to get them to successfully reboot. They'll never survive the changes you're proposing. He leans over the table, putting his finger in John's face. You want to patch it yourself? Fine. But I want a signed piece of paper from you saying that if you push the button and the entire business grinds to a halt, you'll fly around and grovel to all the plant managers, explaining to them why they didn't hit their production targets. Deal? My eyes widen with amazement when John actually leans forward into Wes's finger and says angrily, Oh yeah? How about when we're on the front page of the news because we lost consumer data that we're responsible for protecting? You'll personally apologize to the thousands or millions of families whose data are now being sold by the Russian mafia? I say, Settle down, everyone. We all want to do what's right for the company. The trick is figuring out what we have time to do and what systems can actually be patched. I look at the stack of papers. Wes, Patty, and I can assign people the task of investigating each issue, but who will actually do the work? We're already buried with Phoenix, and I fear that this new massive project might be the straw that breaks the camel's back. I say to Nancy, I'll get with my team right away, and we'll come up with a plan. I can't promise you that we'll have our response letter completed by then, but I can promise you that we'll get you everything we can. Will that be adequate? Quite so, Nancy says amicably. Going through the preliminary audit findings and identifying next steps were the only objectives for this meeting. As the meeting adjourns, I ask Wes to stay behind. Noticing this, John remains behind as well. This is a disaster. All my objectives and bonuses are tied to getting a clean compliance report for the SOX 404 and PCI audits. I'm going to fail because you ops guys can't get your shit together. Join the club, I say. To get him off my back, I say. Sarah and Steve decided to move up the Phoenix deployment date to next Friday. They want to skip all the security reviews. You probably should talk to Chris and Sarah right away. Predictably, John swears and storms out, slamming the door behind him. Exhausted, I lean back in my chair and say to Wes, This is just not our week. Wes laughs humorously. I told you that the pace of things around here would make your head explode. I gesture at the audit findings. We're supposed to protect all our key resources for Phoenix, but that's sucking in everybody.
We don't have a bunch of people just sitting on the bench we can throw at the audit findings, right?
Wes shakes his head, his face uncharacteristically pinched with tension. He flips through his stack of papers again.
We're definitely going to need to bring the technology leads into this, but as you said, they're already assigned to the Phoenix team. Should we reassign them here?
I honestly don't know. Wes stares at one of the pages for a moment.
By the way, I think a bunch of these will require Brent.
Oh, come on, I mutter.
Brent. Can't we do anything without him? Look at us. We're trying to have a management discussion about commitments and resources, and all we do is talk about one guy. I don't care how talented he is. If you're telling me that our organization can't do anything without him, we've got a big problem.
Wes shrugs, slightly embarrassed.
He's undoubtedly one of our best guys. He's really smart, and he knows a lot about almost everything we have in this shop. He's one of the few people who really understand how all the applications talk together at an enterprise level. Heck, the guy may know more about how this company works than I do.
You're a senior manager. This should be as unacceptable to you as it is to me, I say firmly.
How many more Brents do you need? 1, 10, or 100?
I'm going to need Steve to prioritize all this work.
What I need from you is what resources we need. If I ask Steve for more resources, I don't want to have to crawl back, begging for more later.
He rolls his eyes.
Look, I'll tell you right now what's going to happen. We'll go to management and present our case. Not only will they say no, they'll cut our budget by another 5%. That's what they've done for the past 5 years. In the meantime, everyone will continue to want everything at the same time and keep adding to our list of things to do.
Exasperated, he continues.
And just so you know, I have tried to hire more Brents. Because I never got the budget, I eliminated a bunch of people just so I could hire 4 more very senior engineers at the same level of experience as Brent. And you know what happened?
I merely raise my eyebrows.
Wes says, half quit within a year, and I'm not getting anywhere near the productivity I need from the ones who stayed. Although I don't have data to prove it, I'm guessing Brent is even more behind than ever. He complains that he had to spend a bunch of time training and helping the new guys, and is now stretched thinner than ever. And he's still in the middle of everything.
I respond, you said that people add stuff to our list. What does the list look like right now? Where can I get a copy? Who owns the list?
Wes replies slowly, well, there are the business projects and the various IT infrastructure projects, but a lot of the commitments just aren't written down.
How many business projects? How many infrastructure projects? I ask.
Wes shakes his head. I don't know offhand. I can get the list of business projects from Kirsten, but I'm not sure if anyone knows the answer to your second question. Those don't go through the project management office.
I have a sinking feeling in the pit of my stomach.
How can we manage production if we don't know what the demand, priorities, and status of work in process and resource availability are?
Suddenly, I'm kicking myself that I didn't ask these questions on my first day. Finally, I'm thinking like a manager. I call Patty.
Wes and I just got hammered by audit, and they need a response 1 week from Monday. I need your help to figure out what all our work commitments are so I can have an intelligent discussion with Steve about resourcing. Can you talk?
She says, that's right up my alley. Come on over. After Wes briefs Patty on the implications of the mammoth audit report that he thumped down on the table, she whistles.
You know, I really wish you were at that meeting with the auditors, I say. Most of the biggest issues were around the absence of a functional change management process. I think you could end up being the auditor's best friend.
Auditors have friends? She laughs.
I need you to help Wes estimate the work to fix the audit findings by Monday, I say. But right now, let's talk about a higher level issue. I'm trying to get the list of what all our commitments to the organization are. How big is that list, and how do things get on it?
After hearing what Wes told me, Patty replies,
Wes is right.
Kirsten owns the official business project list, almost all of which have something that we're on the hook for. We have our own IT operations projects, which are typically managed by the technology budget owner. There is no centralized list of those projects. Patty continues. We also have all the calls going into the service desk, whether it's requests for something new or asking to fix something. But that list will be incomplete too, because so many people in the business just go to their favorite IT person. All that work is completely off the books. I ask slowly.
So, you're saying that we have no idea what the list of our commitments is?
Really? Wes says defensively. Until now, no one ever asked. We've always hired smart people and tasked them with certain areas of responsibility. We've never had to manage things beyond that.
Well, we need to start. We can't make new commitments to other people when we don't even know what our commitments are now, I say. At the very least, get me the work estimate to fix the audit findings. Then, for each of those resources, tell me what their other commitments are that we're going to be pulling them off of.
Thinking for a moment, I add, for that matter, do the same thing for every person assigned to Phoenix. I'm guessing we're overloaded, so I want to know by how much. I want to proactively tell people whose projects have been bumped so they're not surprised when we don't deliver what we promised.
Both Wes and Patty look surprised. Wes speaks up first.
But we'd have to talk with almost everyone. Patty may have fun grilling people on what changes they're making, but we can't go around wasting the time of our best people. They've got real work to do.
Yes, I know they have real work to do, I say adamantly. I merely want a one-line description about what all that work is and how long they think it will take.
Realizing how this might come across, I add, make sure you tell people that we're doing this so we can get more resources. I don't want anyone thinking that we're outsourcing or firing anyone, okay? Patty nods.
We should have done this a long time ago. We bump up the priorities of things all the time, but we never really know what just got bumped down. That is, until someone screams at us, demanding to know why we haven't delivered something.
She types on her laptop.
You just want a list of organizational commitments for our key resources, with a one-liner on what they're working on and how long it will take. We'll start with all Phoenix and audit remediation resources first, but we'll eventually cover the entire IT operations organization. Do I have it right?
I smile, genuinely happy that Patty has framed it so succinctly. I know she's going to do a great job.
Exactly.
Bonus points if you and Wes can determine which resources are most overutilized and how many new resources we need. That would be the basis of an ask to Steve for more staffing.
Patty says to Wes, this should be pretty straightforward. We can put together 15-minute interviews, pull data from our service desk and ticketing system, get Kirsten's project list.
Surprisingly, Wes agrees, adding,
we could also look in our budgeting tools to see how we've coded personnel and hardware requests.
I stand up.
Great thinking, guys. Get a meeting set up for us to go over what you find, no later than Friday. I want to have a meeting with Steve on Monday, armed with some real data.
She gives me the thumbs up.
Now we're getting somewhere.
Chapter 6. Friday, September 5th. In another one of the endless Phoenix status meetings, I realize that the developers are even more behind than we feared. As Wes had predicted, more and more work is being deferred to the next release, including almost all of the testing. This means that we'll be the ones finding the problems when they blow up in production, instead of the quality assurance QA department.
Great.
During a lull in the discussion, I look down at my phone and see an email from Patty. She wants to meet about resourcing, promising some eye-opening surprises. I open the attached spreadsheet, seeing an encouraging level of detail, but on my minuscule phone screen, I can't make heads or tails of it. I reply to Patty that I'm on the way, and ask her to have Wes meet me there. When I arrive, I'm surprised to see that Wes has set up a projector, displaying a spreadsheet on the wall. I'm excited that we're meeting to analyze the situation, instead of just reacting to the daily fires. I grab a seat.
Okay, what you got for me?
Wes starts. Patty did a great job putting this together. What we found was... well, it was interesting.
Patty explains.
We did our interviews, collected the data, and then did our analysis. Right now, these numbers are only for our key resources. We're already seeing something troubling.
She points at a row in the spreadsheet.
First, we have a lot of projects. Kirsten says she's officially managing about 35 major business projects, each of which we have commitments to. Internal to IT operations, we've already identified over 70 projects, and that number keeps growing with each person we interview.
Wait, I say, genuinely startled, sitting upright in my chair. We have 150 IT operations people, right? If you've already found over 105 projects, that's 1.5 people per project. Doesn't that seem like a lot to you?
Wes replies, totally. And we know that the project count is low. So by the end, it'll probably be more like one person per project. That's insane.
I ask, how big are these internal projects?
Wes switches tabs on the spreadsheet, showing the list of projects they've inventoried, along with the estimated number of man weeks. Consolidate and upgrade email server. Upgrade 35 instances of Oracle databases. Install supported Lemming database server. Virtualize and migrate primary business applications, and so on.
I groan. While some projects are small, most seem like major undertakings, estimated at 3 man-years or more.
When Patty sees the expression on my face, she says, that was my reaction too. We're on the hook for a huge number of projects, so let's look at what our capacity is. This is a little harder, since we can't just assign random people to any given project.
She continues.
When we looked at who was assigned to each project and what their other commitments and availability were, here's what we found.
When Wes flips to another spreadsheet tab, my heart drops.
Grim, huh? Says Wes. Most of our resources are going to Phoenix. And look at the next line. Compliance is the next largest project. And even if we only worked on compliance, it would still consume most of our key resources for an entire year. And that includes Brent, by the way.
Incredulous, I say, you're kidding.
If we put all our projects on hold, except for the audit findings, our key resources would be tied up for an entire year.
Yep, Patty says, nodding.
It's hard to believe, but it just shows you how much work is in that stack of audit findings.
I look down at the table, speechless.
If someone had shown me these figures during my first conversation with Steve, I would have run from the room, screaming like a little boy.
It's not too late, I think, smiling at the image. With practiced calm, I say, okay, knowing is always better than not knowing. Keep going.
Wes looks back at the spreadsheet. The third largest item is incident and break fix work. Right now, it's probably consuming 75% of our staff's time. And because these often involve critical business systems, incidents will take priority over everything else, including Phoenix and fixing audit findings. By the way, did you know that yesterday, when we were talking with Brent, we had to reschedule the interview twice because he had to go help fix an outage? So there we were, interrupting him from Phoenix work, only to be interrupted by an outage, he says, laughing.
I start to laugh, but then stop abruptly.
Wait, what outage? Why didn't I hear about it? We can't keep running our organization like this.
Well, it was another SAN issue, but nothing critical, Wes replies. A drive went bad a couple of months ago, so the SAN was running with no redundancy. When another drive failed, the entire volume went down. Brent had to help restore some of the databases when we got the SAN back up.
Exasperated, I shout, dang it, Wes! That was completely preventable. Get one of your junior guys to look at the logs every day for drive failures. Maybe even have him visually inspect the drives and count all the blinking lights. It's called preventative maintenance for a reason. We need Brent on Phoenix, not piddly shit like this.
Wes says defensively,
hey, it's actually a little more complicated than that. We put in the order for replacement drives, but they've been stuck in procurement for weeks.
We had to get one of our vendors to give it to us on credit. This wasn't our fault.
I lose my temper.
Wes, listen to me. I don't care. I don't care about procurement. I don't care how nice your inept vendors are. I need you to do your job. Make sure this doesn't happen again.
I take a deep breath. I realize my frustration is not because of the drive failure, but because we're continually unable to stay focused on the things that matter most to the company. Look, let's put this aside for now, I say, looking back at Wes.
I'm serious about getting someone to look at that SAN daily, though.
Set up a meeting sometime next week for you, me, and Patty to get to the bottom of these outages. We've got to figure out how to bring down the amount of break-fix work so we can get project work done. If we can't get Phoenix work done, it's jeopardizing the company.
Yeah, I got it. I'll try to get it in before the Phoenix rollout, Wes says, nodding sullenly.
And I'll get on that SAN issue this afternoon.
Okay, back to the spreadsheet, I say. Patty observes glumly.
You're right. The one consistent theme in the interviews was that everyone struggles to get their project work done. Even when they do have time, they struggle to prioritize all their commitments. People in the business constantly ask our staff to do things for them, especially marketing.
Sarah? I ask.
Sure, but it's not only her, she replies. Practically every executive in the company is guilty of going directly to their favorite IT person, either asking a favor or pressuring them to get something done.
How do we change the game here and get resourced to do all these projects properly? I ask. What should we be asking Steve for? Wes scrolls down his spreadsheet.
Based on our rough numbers, we'll probably need to hire 7 people, 3 database administrators, 2 server engineers, 1 network engineer, and 1 virtualization engineer. Of course, you know that it'll take time to find these people and then another 6 to 12 months before they're fully productive.
Of course I knew that new hires aren't productive right away, but it was still dispiriting to hear Wes point out that real help was still a long way off, even if Steve approved the headcount. Later that day,
as I'm walking to our second CAB meeting,
I feel hopeful. If we can get our old change process going, we might be able to quickly resolve one of the largest audit issues and get some operational wins as well. I'm also pleased at how well Patty and Wes are working together. As I near the conference room, I hear loud voices arguing.
Then Patty got that engineer fired for doing his job. He was one of our best networking people. That wasn't your call to make.
No mistake. That's Wes hollering. Then I hear Patty reply heatedly,
What? You signed off on that termination. Why is this suddenly my fault?
I knew it was too good to be true. Then I hear John say, That was the right call. We're going into our 3rd year of repeat audit finding around change controls. That goes in front of the audit committee. Next time around, it probably won't be just an engineer getting fired, if you get my drift.
Wait, who invited John to this meeting?
Before John can make things any worse, I quickly step through the door and say cheerfully, Good afternoon, everyone. Are we ready to review some changes? 14 people turn to look at me. Most of the technical leads from the various groups are sitting at the table. Wes is standing up behind his chair, fuming, while Patty is standing in the front of the room, arms crossed. John sits in the back of the room with his 3-ring binder open, very much an unwanted guest. Using both hands, I set down my antique laptop. It hits the table with a thud and a clatter as the battery falls off, the tape no longer holding it in place. And then I hear a scratching sound as the disk drive spins down. Wes's angry expression disappears momentarily.
Wow, boss. Nice gear. What is that, a K-Pro 2? I haven't seen one of those in about 30 years. Let me know if you need an 8-inch floppy to load CPM on it. I've got one in my attic at home.
2 of the engineers snicker and point. I smile briefly at Wes, grateful for the comic relief. Remaining standing, I say to everyone, Let me tell you why I assembled all of you here. Given the urgency of Phoenix, you can bet your ass that I wouldn't waste your time if I didn't think this was important. I continue. First,
The events that led to the SAN and payroll failure on Tuesday must not happen again. What started off as a medium-sized payroll failure snowballed into a massive friendly fire SAN incident.
Why? Because we are not talking to one another about what changes we're planning or implementing. This is not acceptable. Second, John is right. We spent yesterday morning with our auditors, discussing a bunch of deficiencies they found. I continue. Dick Landry is already crapping bricks because it could impact our quarterly financial statements. We need to tighten up our change controls, and as managers and technical leads, we must figure out how we can create a sustainable process that will prevent friendly fire incidents and get the auditors off our back, while still being able to get work done. We are not leaving this room until we've created a plan to get there. Understood. When I'm satisfied that everyone has been properly cowed, I open it up for discussion. So, what's preventing us from getting there? One of the technical leads quickly says, I'll start. That change management tool is impossible to use. There's a million mandatory fields, and most of the time, the drop-down boxes for the applications affected don't even have what I need. It's why I've stopped even putting in change requests. Another lead hollers out, he's not kidding. To follow Patty's rules, I have to manually type in hundreds of server names in one of the text boxes. Most of the time, there's not enough room in the field. 100 server names are supposed to fit in a 64-character text box? What idiot built that form? Again, more unkind laughter. Patty is bright red. She shouts, we need to use drop-down boxes so we can maintain data integrity. And I'd love to keep the application list up to date, but I don't have the resources. Who's going to keep the application catalog and change management database current? You think it just magically updates itself?
It's not just the tool, Patty. It's the entire broken process, Wes asserts. When my guys put in change requests, they have to wait a lifetime to get approvals, let alone get on the schedule. We have the business breathing down our neck to get crap done. We can't wait for you to hem and haw, complaining that we didn't fill out the form right, Patty snaps. That's crap and you know it. Your people routinely break the rules, like, say, when everyone marks all their change requests as an urgent or emergency change. That field is only for actual emergencies, Wes retorts. We have to do that, because marking them urgent is the only way to get your team to look at it. Who can wait 3 weeks for an approval?
One of the lead engineers suggests, maybe we can make another field called extremely urgent. I wait until the uproar quiets down. At this rate, we're getting nowhere fast. Thinking furiously, I finally say, let's take a 10-minute break. When we reconvene the meeting, I say, we are not leaving this meeting without a list of authorized and scheduled changes that we're implementing in the next 30 days. As you can see, my assistant has brought in a pile of blank index cards. I want each group to write down every change they're planning, one change per index card. I want three pieces of information. Who is planning the change, the system being changed, and a one-sentence summary. I've drawn a calendar on the whiteboard where we will eventually post approved changes according to their scheduled implementation, I continue. Those are the rules, short and simple. Wes picks up a pack of cards, looking at them dubiously.
Really? Paper cards in this day and age? How about we use that laptop of yours, which probably even predates paper?
Everyone laughs, but not Patty. She looks angry, obviously not pleased with the direction things are going.
This isn't like any change management process I've ever seen, John says. But I'll put my changes on the board, like the upcoming firewall updates and monitoring changes that are scheduled for the next couple of days.
Surprisingly, John's willingness to jump in inspires others, who begin writing their planned changes on their cards. Finally, Wes says,
okay, let's try it. Anything is better than using that busted change management tool.
One of the leads holds up a handful of cards.
I'm done with all the database changes we're planning to make.
When I nod for him to proceed, he quickly reads one of the cards.
Execute the vendor-recommended database maintenance script on Octave server XZ577 to fix retail store POS performance issues. This affects the order entry database and applications.
We'd like to do this next Friday evening at 8:30 p.m. I nod, pleased with the clarity of his proposed change. But Wes says,
"That's not a change. That's just running a database script. If you were changing the script, then we'd have something to talk about. Next."
The lead replies quickly,
"No, it's definitely a change. It temporarily changes some database settings, and we don't know what production impact it could have. To me, it's just as risky as a database configuration change."
Is it a change or not? I can see both sides of the argument. After 30 minutes of arguing, it's still not clear that we know the definition of what a change should be. Was rebooting a server a change? Yes, because we don't want anyone rebooting servers willy-nilly, especially if it's running a critical service. How about turning off a server? Yes, for the same reason. How about turning on a server? No, we all thought. That is, until someone came up with the example of turning on a duplicate DHCP server, which screwed up the entire enterprise network for 24 hours. A half hour later, we finally write on the whiteboard, "A change is any activity that is physical, logical, or virtual to applications, databases, operating systems, networks, or hardware that could impact services being delivered." I look at my watch, alarmed that we've been in the room for nearly 90 minutes, and we still haven't even approved our first change. I push us to move faster, but at the end of our two-hour meeting, we've only posted 5 changes on the whiteboard. Surprisingly, no one else seems frustrated except me. Everyone is vigorously engaged in the discussion, even Patty. Everyone is discussing risks of the proposed changes, even discovering that one change wasn't necessary. Encouraged, I say, "We'll pick this up on Monday. Get all your cards to Patty as soon as you can. Patty, what's the best way for us to process all the cards?" She says tersely, "I'll set up a basket later today. In the meantime, pile them up at the front of the table." When we adjourn, several people tell me on their way out, "Great meeting," and "I wish we had more time to discuss changes," and "I'm looking forward to Monday." Only Patty has remained behind, arms crossed. "We spent a lot of blood, sweat, and tears creating our old change management policy, and everyone still blew it off. What makes you think this will be any different?" I shrug. "I don't know. But we'll keep trying things until we have a system that works. And I'm going to make sure everyone keeps helping us get there. It's not just to satisfy the audit findings. We need some way to plan, communicate, and make our changes safely. I can guarantee you that if we don't change the way we work, I'll be soon out of a job." Pointing at her old policy document, she says, "We shouldn't just throw all this work out the window. We spent weeks designing it and hundreds of thousands of dollars with consultants, changing our tools around." She tears up slightly. I remind myself of how long she's been trying to get this process integrated into the organization. "I know that there was a lot of good work put into all this process," I say sympathetically. "Let's face it, though. No one was actually following it, as the auditors pointed out. We also know that people were gaming the system, just trying to get their work done." I say sincerely, "We may be starting over, but we need all your experience and skills to make this work. It's still your process. And I know this is absolutely critical to our success." "Okay," she says, sighing in resignation. "I suppose I care more about our survival than whether we use our old process or not." Her expression changes. "How about I write up the outputs of the meeting and the new instructions for submitting requests for changes?" Later that afternoon, I'm back in the Phoenix War Room when Patty calls. I run out to the hallway. "What's up?" She sounds stressed.
"We've got a problem. I was expecting we'd have 50 changes for us to review next week, but we're already up to 243 submitted changes. I keep getting emails from people saying to expect more cards over the weekend. I think we're looking at over 400 changes being made next week." Holy crap. 400? How many of these 400 changes are high risk, potentially affecting Phoenix, the payroll application, or worse? I suddenly remember range master duty in the Marines.
As rangemaster, I was responsible for the safety of everyone on the firing range. I have a horrifying vision of a mob of 400 unsupervised 18-year-olds jumping out of trucks, running to the firing range, firing their rifles into the air, hooting and hollering. At least people are following the process, I say, laughing nervously. I hear her laugh.
With all the change requests coming in, how are we going to get them all authorized by Monday? Should we put a temporary hold on changes until we get them all approved?
Absolutely not, I say immediately. The best way to kill everyone's enthusiasm and support is to prevent them from doing what they need to do. I doubt we'll get a second chance to get this right. Send out an email telling everyone to submit any change for next week by Monday. Monday's changes will not need to be authorized, but changes for the remainder of the week will. No exceptions. I can hear Patty typing over the phone.
Got it. I'll probably need to have some of my people help organize all of the change cards over the weekend. Frankly, I'm stunned by how many changes there are.
So am I. Excellent, I say, leaving my concerns unvoiced.